captured my heart and you raptured my soul with your glory. Would you captured my heart and you raptured my soul with your glory. Yes, you captured my heart and you raptured my soul with your glory. Captured my heart and you raptured my soul with your glory. Yes, you captured my heart and you raptured my soul with your glory. Lord, you captured my heart and you raptured my soul in your glory. Lord, you captured my heart and you raptured my soul in your glory. You captured my heart and you raptured my soul in your glory. Lord, you captured my heart and you raptured my soul in your glory. Lord, you captured my heart and you raptured my soul with your glory. Lord, you captured my heart and you raptured my soul with your glory. Lord, you captured my heart and you raptured my soul with your glory. My soul with your glory. Lord, you captured my heart and you raptured my soul with your glory. Lord, you captured my heart and you raptured my soul with your glory. You captured my heart and you raptured my soul with your glory. Lord, you captured my heart and you raptured my soul with your glory.
Hallelujah.
Lord, you captured my heart and you raptured my soul with your glory. Lord, you captured my heart and you raptured my soul with your glory. Lord, you captured my heart and you raptured my soul with your glory. Lord, you captured my heart and you raptured my soul with your glory. And you've captured my heart, and you raptured my soul with your glory.
Jesus, how glorious, Lord Jesus. How glorious, Jesus. How wonderful, God. How wonderful is your name. How wonderful is your great salvation. Jesus, we worship you. Lord Jesus, we praise you.
Complete, consumed by your love, your presence so sweet. What a miracle, what glory divine. You call me friend, and I am yours. Jesus, Majesty, Jesus, eternal King. I'm found in you, completely complete, consumed by your love, your presence so sweet. What a miracle, what glory divine. You call me friend, and I am yours. Lord Jesus, 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 Majesty, Lord Jesus. Jesus, Jesus, eternal King. Jesus. Jesus, Majesty.
You're the mighty, you're the mighty, you're the mighty, you're the mighty one. You're the mighty, you're the mighty, you're the mighty, you're the mighty one. You're the mighty, you're the mighty, you're the mighty, you're the mighty one. You're the mighty, you're the mighty, you're the mighty, you're the mighty one. You're the mighty, you're the mighty, you're the mighty, you're the mighty one. You're the mighty. God of all creation, you're the God of all creation, you're the God of all creation, you're the God of all creation. Oh, you're the mighty. Hey!
voice. Don't be silent. Come on, come on.
Jesus,
Hallelujah. Mangana mangere mamande rama mamande. Carabe, mamase, mamake, mamasur. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus.
I'm found in you, completely complete, consumed by your love.
Mama na manjekine na mambara na manjeri na mankere na manshikando lo mosikra mama manderi mamandara na masito.
What glory divine.
Mi bravo de teri na manrebe beberre mamasato na dia su.
I am yours.
Thank you, mambara na mambrebe de kisi siado.
Jesus,
Lord Jesus.
Jesus,
Lord Jesus,
Jesus, Majesty.
Father wants to take you to a place where you can come to understand that He is a spirit, and that they that worship Him must worship Him in spirit. And I'm sorry, I apologize that you were born into the wrong models. You were born into the wrong things that you really believed were right. I'm sorry. But reality of it is everybody has the Bible, everybody has the Word of God, everybody can see very clearly what Father has produced. Everybody's got Acts chapter 2. Everybody's got the wonderful works and the ministry of Jesus as He showed us what it meant to walk with the Father and live out a relationship with Him. He showed us the kind of passion and He showed us the kind of demonstration of the Holy Ghost that is supposed to exist. And we pray in the name of Jesus Christ that from this day forward you just begin to take a hold of that which God has revealed in His Word, and you begin to demand it for your soul and follow those who live in it. Hallelujah. You can follow me. I live in it. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And I tell you right now, it won't take you a couple of months and you'll be learning how to shout. Hallelujah. It won't take you a couple of months. Won't take you but a couple of months and you'll have revival in your living room. You'll have a move of God. I can have a move of God and never leave my house. And I know that in that move of God, there are things happening not only in my life, preparing me to go and be able to see people's lives changed and the church refreshed and brought back to where it was supposed to be. Hallelujah. But also, there's things being changed and moved around in preparation for what's getting ready to happen in Kashmir. Well, the things that are getting ready to happen in Cuba. The things that are getting ready to happen in West Nepal. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Come here, baby. Come stand here. You can be seated. You know, the awesome thing that I have is I have a Holy Ghost woman. I listen to me, dear people. You listen to me. Because I'm telling you right now, you listen to me. You are going to be held responsible by the Lord Jesus Christ of how you fashioned yourself and patterned yourself after those that God gave to you. And He knows. Father knows. Listen to me now. Father looks at every person's heart and He tries them and He sees where their passions are. Father sees it when you're up against all of the adversity and all of the persecution and all the discouragement and disappointment, but yet you stand firm and say, I am for greater works and I will do greater works. I mean, if I was a paraplegic, paralyzed from my neck down, blind in both eyes and deaf in both ears, and all I could do was speak, I'd be saying, I'm called for greater works, I'm going to do greater works. Oh, yeah, you know why? Because I resolved myself many years ago to live by the Word of God and not by popular opinion. And I'm going to tell you right now, popular opinion comes right out of the mind of the powers of darkness, the prince of the power of the air. And I have discovered that most of God's people have never learned how to distinguish the difference between the Word of God and the things that the Spirit of God speaks out in the atmosphere.
Now, you say, oh, well, I know. No, you don't. Not necessarily. You may know it intellectually, but you don't know how your decision processes have been working. And if I could get everybody to start making their decisions based upon what God says by His Word and under the unction of the Holy Ghost, if I could get you to come to a place to recognize that I'm not just giving you some fantasy idea about the way that you live your life, but are reporting unto you the good news that are brought to us by the Word of God, that you can have, you can touch heaven in such a way that the glory of His own Holy Spirit will be expressed through you every day. That there is a realm of prayer that will take you into a place that will change you. You'll change your behavior and the way that you sing, the way that you interact. Listen, people, I watch people distracted with all kinds of things. All it tells me is that you've not matured anything beyond distraction. Whatever it is that gets you, that's where you're at. Whatever it is that distracts you, that stops you, that's the level of your growth. And God has purposed that you grow and become so in love with Him that you're captivated by His presence, that you have a longing heart for Him. You know, today, you know, Ann was bringing to my attention some of the great revivals of the past. And, you know, we were talking about one great revival that started in 1948. Seven men went into a barn, and they began to pray and cry out to God because they were burdened for souls. Seven men. And because of the deadness of the church. And it wasn't long, and a great revival took place that changed the course of the church and of the nations. And out of that, there sprang up so many great revivals and so many signs and wonders in just off the shore of Scotland. How many of you know what I'm talking about? Huh? How many of you know what I'm talking about? Anybody know the name of the revival?
Hebrides.
That's right, the Hebrides revival. Seven men. Follow my wife. She's filled with the Holy Ghost. Why don't you just follow her?
Yes.
Why don't you just behave yourself?
Yes.
Ask God to show you how. She's filled with the Holy Ghost. I can get her to prophesy right now. There's many of you I could not get to prophesy right now, but God wants you to be able to prophesy. You would not know how to speak by the Spirit. All you would do is speak right out of your head and out of your intellect. And we want better things than you. I'm going to tell you right now, Father gave me something tonight that I get to release to everybody. I was so excited. When He gave it to me, an anointing, a glory, an anointing came upon me that I absolutely live for. And so the Spirit of the Lord gives us those things that we may give them away. So if you're ready, you know, I've tried to say to the Lord, Father, can I just leave some people alone who will not pay attention? Their hearts are not captivated by You. They're always distracted. They're either looking at their grandchildren or they're playing with their pen and paper or whatever. You know, I've often asked the Lord, can I just leave it alone and go on about the business of paying attention to people that want to grow and mature? And the Lord won't allow me. He says, no, discipline them. If they won't listen to you, I'll take it from there. I'll discipline them. And I'm going to tell you right now, the disciplining of the Lord isn't about a broken ankle. It isn't about bad finances. It's about you getting left out of the realms of the anointing. And if you're okay with that, you've got a problem. You've got a serious problem in your life that can only be cured by the saving grace and knowledge of the Lord Jesus Christ. The blood is here to cleanse us and wash us. The Holy Ghost is here to empower us. But see, the thing about it is, if you're not captivated, you're captivated with what is real to you and what you really love. I am captivated with the Lord Jesus Christ and with the Holy Ghost because He's real to me and I really love Him. And this is His house. This isn't nobody else's house. This isn't about other things. People don't get that. This is about Him. This is about sacred things and holy things that Father's not going to allow you to trample over. And when you trample over the sacred now, in any level, He holds you right there. You're not allowed to move forward because you've not learned how to handle the holy things, the sacred things. And when you've not learned how to handle those holy things and the sacred things, you're going to die. Nadab and Abihu. Somebody said, that's the Old Testament. No, it's just the Testament. It's how Father feels about His holy things. I watch people come into the meeting, not only here, but other places, and they just do their own thing. It's going on in their head. You can see it. It's going on in their head. They're doing their own thing. And you're going to have to understand, when you do that, you actually are trampling over the sacred things of God. And you better start honoring God, because I'm telling you right now, I don't know how much you can be sacrilegious. And that is to violate the sacred and ever make heaven. Because I believe the more you violate the sacred, the more you disrespect the Holy Ghost, the harder your heart gets. And ultimately, that can become a form of blasphemy against the Holy Ghost. Because the Holy Spirit is very sacred to Father. And I'm going to tell you right now, the people that are most responsible are the people who've sat in the church the longest. And somebody just comes in off the street, they aren't even got any responsibility. And yet usually they're captivated. But people sit around in the church and they can just walk around, do whatever it is they want to do. And people sitting behind you, they watch you. Don't you understand that? The people behind you are distracted by what you're doing. When will you begin to think beyond the inward spectrum of yourself and begin to look around you at a world that Christ Jesus died for? This is very important for you. Because you never get to grow and you never get to mature until you begin to honor the Holy Ghost. You begin to call His sacred things sacred. You begin to call that which is holy honorable. You cease to do your own pleasure and you begin to do His pleasure. That's living first for the kingdom of God. A lot of people say that they live first for the kingdom of God. They're not. They do their own pleasure. They walk in their own self. They walk in their own will. If you know, they disagree, they just go and chart their own course. And you're not making heaven, charting your own course. You'll let the Holy Ghost chart your course. You're going to come under the rule and the authority of the Holy Ghost. Otherwise, you're left out. And it is so sad because God's people have left the work of the many to the few. And Father has purposed to change that, and He's going to change it. I know He is. And it may be that Father has to raise up another generation of just people out there that right now don't even know God. But the moment they do know Him, they're going to have the response of James and so many other people that I can show you, that they didn't sit around in church becoming religious and fossilizing. They took a hold of the Word of God and said, I'm going to do this. I'm going to live this. I'm going to do exactly what God says. I'm going to lay hands on the sick. I'm going to mature and grow in the things of heaven because I want heaven more than I want earth. You know, we just changed our, we exchanged our lives. He, by His grace, gave us a wonderful exchange. He gave us His life. Hallelujah. Praise God. I thank God for the anointing of the Holy Ghost on this platform. I'm telling you right now, I see greatness being formed on this platform. Greatness in the kingdom of God. Greatness. I see greatness being formed. I see greatness being formed out here among you. Because Father's looking to raise up people to go about and do the ministry, the work of the ministry, to live out the life of Jesus Christ, His life and His power. Father gave us the promise of the Father, the dearest and most sacred things to Him, that we might be endued with power from on high, that we might be witnesses of His resurrection. Now listen to me. Not just the literal reality that He raised from the dead and that He's seated on the right hand of the Father, but that we were raised up together with Him. And that we are alive together with Him, and that His life is seen, lived out in us. Amen. You're gonna, this has to become more important to you than anything else, otherwise you never have it. And then you can go ahead and lie to yourself, and you can say that you got it, and people just don't understand, and they're not sensitive to you, and they don't care. That's just a bunch of nonsense. You need to read the Bible and start conforming to what God said in His Word. Amen. Quit pretending and conform. Amen. Okay? Quit being a hypocrite. Amen. Saying that you're doing it, not doing it. Are you listening to me? And I'm going to command you to do that. As long as I'm in this tabernacle, I'm going to watch out for your soul. I'm going to tell you where it is that you're off. And you can either become disappointed and not want to participate and go home because you didn't want to become a person developed in the things of God. Because he that strives for masteries must strive lawfully. Otherwise, he's never going to win. He's never going to be crowned. You're never going to be crowned. I said crowned with the crown of righteousness. I say you're never going to be crowned with His glory, with His honor. There's never going to be anything. You're never going to move past the marginalized Christian, which the world despises. The world despises on this level that they look at it as not a testimony against them, but something that they don't want to have, just religious. You with me?
Yes.
Because I'm going to be hated by the world and the spirit of the world, but at least I'm going to shine with the glory of His power and His might and His majesty and be distinctively the light of the world. Amen.
Amen.
And that's what God's called you and I to be. He's called us to be the light of the world.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Lights. We are those who are blameless and who are harmless. The sons of God. Hallelujah. Who shine as lights.
Hallelujah.
In the midst of this dark, and evil and wicked world. I want you to open up your Bibles here in just a minute. I'm gonna ease you into something, because I'm gonna give you a very strong word here in just a little bit. And the word that I'm gonna give you from heaven will impart to you the ability to do it. It's radical. It's gonna impart to you the usupanaya. I'm telling you right now, we're going to preach the Word of God with the demonstration of the Holy Ghost. And if you grab a hold of the Word of God, if you grab a hold and respond to what God's doing, you'll wake up in His likeness and you go, how did I get this way? How did I get different? Father will give you things, hallelujah, that you've been praying for. Seven men started praying. And for the deadness of the church and for lost souls. And within a short span of time, it didn't take long. After a few years, suddenly there came the rain of heaven and the pouring out of the glory of God through their life. I just want to see somebody start taking up their place in the kingdom of God. And I want to talk to you about that. And I want to help you to begin to understand your different places and positions and roles that you can play. And then I'm going to build this thing to a place that, I mean, I'm going to come right at you with some intense stuff that's ultimately going to cause you to step over into a realm of wisdom and revelation. But you're going to have to hunger for this. Because if you don't, it ain't going to happen. But if you do, I'm telling you right now, it's going to happen. There's going to be change. Don't go to Mazedeya. People, I'm going to tell you, too many of you are under the influence of fashioning yourself after religion and fashioning yourself after popular opinion and even fashioning yourself after the world, and you're not going to move forward with that, okay? What I need to do is I need to help you first and foremost to recognize that your life is not about what you've been living it for. Your life is not about your little microcosms of whatever it is that you're doing and how you then try to justify it and make it fit in the Word. That's not your life. Let's look at what your life is supposed to be. Your life is supposed to be about going into all the world and preaching the gospel. And I'm going to talk to you about various different dimensions of this, of how you will grow into it, how you'll develop into it, and how that then you're going to mature in the giftings of the Holy Ghost because you're willing. So the Lord said He gave us, He empowered us so that we can go to Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, to the uttermost parts of the world. And so what happens is Father has purposed that you and I, going into all the world, either every single person has a global missions plan. And if you don't have a global missions plan for your life, you need to get yourself one. Amen. And I'm going to help you understand. People, this year, We're going to, you know, southern India, just to name a few places. We're going to southern India, Kashmir, Zambia, Africa, to do the conference for the missionaries that are in the bush there, to be a part of refreshing them and helping them and blessing them. We're going to do a mass evangelism crusade in Cuba, a mass evangelism crusade in western Nepal, in Dagadi, Nepal. And that's not where it started with me. Where it started with me is just being wherever I was at and bringing people together for prayer and for a Bible study. Whether I was at work before I ever started going to school, when I went to school in college, just bringing people together for prayer and for a Bible study for the very single purpose of pressing into that realm of Acts 1:8 so that we could go do the stuff. Because unless you're endued with power from on high, you won't have fire in your belly and you won't have a capacity to even know where to begin. Look, seven men went into a barn and began to pray because they begin to get a capacity. They begin to have the reality of the fire of God burning in their belly. They begin to get a reality of what they were called to do. And suddenly their life wasn't about their business anymore. Their life wasn't about them trying to make themselves fit into the Word of God. People are always doing this. I watch it. I watch where many, and even in this place, where you try to make your life fit into the Word instead of make the Word fit into your life rather than conforming your life to the Word. And you're going to have to just shut that down. You're going to have to understand, if you do not have a prayer life, because it begins right there, if you don't have a prayer life for Jerusalem, for Judea, for Samaria, and the uttermost parts of the world, you haven't even begun. And I'm not talking about a prayer life that says, oh God, help Uncle Tim, Aunt Susie, and Aunt Sally, and oh God, please bring this, and we want a dog, and whatever else. I'm talking about you getting over into a realm where you learn how to pray. And usually it takes some fasting to learn how to pray, because you got to break through you. You got to break through the things that have governed your life, the emotional disposition that has ruled your life. And for some people, it's melancholy and depression. Some people, it's tiredness of body. Some people, it's just distraction because they're addicted to entertainment. The list goes on. But nonetheless, everybody's got to break through to a realm where all of a sudden God takes control. I'm telling you, I can tell you here tonight about a realm that you can come into where God the Holy Ghost takes control, where it's not even you. You can't even shut it off. It's as it goes, it's as though it goes beyond your will, where it starts without your will and it goes on and continues, even when you're distracted and need to do something else, where you are apprehended by God. There is a place to grow and mature. But I'm going to tell you right now, to be able to go in that, you're going to have to break past all the things that stop you, that distract you, that disappoint you, that discourage you, that overwhelm you, and it's just a tired body. Or just setting other things, making them other things important, or being willing to be discouraged by other ideas and thoughts and purposes and values that you placed upon yourself. If your only value is heaven, nothing can mess with you. If your only purpose is heaven, nothing can mess with you. It doesn't even matter. It's the water off a duck's back. And thus you constantly live in a masitara na pro papaya. You constantly live in a masitara diaha. You obey God and you're continually filled with the Spirit. There are very few people in this place that live their life today being continually filled with the Spirit. Very few. And that is a sad reality and a story of disobedience that goes on in the church. Because you don't have time. I'm going to tell you right now, I'm going to help you. I'm here to help you. Tonight I'm here to release something to you so that you can begin to get yourself a heavenly vision and get out of your earthly one. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I live in an awesome presence and awareness of God. You can call that Holy Ghost conviction, okay? But so many people live under a place of condemnation. I mean, come on, people. God's got the life for you over here. And you're going to have to break through the things that you've allowed to fortify against you, beginning with you and your decisions. If you'd stop having your opinion and thinking that you're so bright and understand so many things and can clearly think through whatever, then God would be able to give you insight concerning what's really going on. So people are going to have to get comfortable with just being able to say, I don't know. You know, because you're going to have to recognize that the things that of the wisdom of men is foolishness to God, okay? And then that's a hard place for most people to come, because they're always, well, what do you think? I don't think anything. I don't want to think. Oh, but I was looking for your opinion. I don't have one. Let's pray. Let's get ahead and reach into a realm called the heavenlies, and let's begin to make contact with God. Woo! To make contact with God. I know many of you are not even excited about that because it is irrelevant to you. It's irrelevant to you. It's condemnation to you. But some people in here are excited. I want to make contact with God. I want to make contact with God. Listen, I'm going to tell you right now, the people that receive from God are those who reach out and grab it, and those who receive. Those who say, yes, I want this. Yes, I'm needy. Because so many people have left Sunday night, and all you did was from Sunday night to this night, you lived for yourself. And Father sees it. This is part of why he told me what I'm going to tell you tonight. Because I'm telling you right now, I'm going to ask you, I want you to understand something. You got a window of opportunity. And that door will close because it's a window. And that door will close. Your life is a window of opportunity. The things, the callings of God are a window of opportunity. You don't continually go on doing what you want to do. You're listening to me.
Yes.
And then think that it's just going to be that way. It's just open-ended. No, Father says, I give you a space of time to repent. Do it. Do it. Otherwise, I'll come and remove your opportunity from you. And so somebody's going to have to start getting serious about walking with God. That's just all there is to it. Somebody's going to have to get serious about contact with God. Quit playing mind games with yourself and acting like you're so already there when you're not. Because if you were, there would be a spiritual expression and maturity. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We wouldn't have to constantly feel that we got to make up your slack so that the church can look like the church. Can you hear me? Oh, it's true. Ha ha ha. And I'm telling you right now, preachers watching to me right now on the web, you know it's true too. It's just people constantly have to make up everybody's slack so the church got some kind of a move of God, some kind of anointing. Because everybody's sitting around, you know, doing this number or doing whatever it is that they're distracted with. It is time for you to get real with God, get serious with God, and understand what your purpose of existence is. And if you're not doing it, you're disobedient. You're not right with God. On the fundamental basis, we were born of the Spirit to live out the life of Jesus. Yeah. Not to live out any kind of life that we so choose to live and say that, you know, all it is about, you know, I try to be good and do good and live good and treat everybody right. Nonsense. That's not what the Lord said in His Word. That's not what He said. This is what I want you to do. I'm gonna bring forth this wonderful new creation and give you and do you a power from on high so that you can live right and do right and act like, be good. That's not what He said. He said so that you can be witnesses of the resurrection. In Jerusalem, in Judea, hallelujah, in Samaria, hallelujah, and the uttermost parts of the earth. You know, I was really blessed by James telling his story again. Is where he started. All he could start was with half a potato and a pork chop. Took that and literally in his rude and, you know, kind of Connecticut gangy type attitude, went and kicked a homeless guy, handed him the plate of food, said, I'm your new pastor. So, I mean, you know, that's how the church started and the things that God did with them. I mean, I've got a similar story. Everybody I know has got a similar story. And nobody told me I had to go to the street and preach. I had a fire in my belly. Huh? Nobody had to tell me about the direction I was going to take. God visited me in the night and set before me all the various different options and opportunities I had in life. I said, Lord, I just want to serve you. Father, I want to understand how to move forward with you. Father, I just want the anointing. Father, I want your manifest power. God, the things you've got's all I want. And yeah, I had many choices along the way, and that just made it that much better. And I want to help you begin. I want to help you understand that, you know, when we talk about verses of Scripture, for example, Philippians 4:17, we talk about 2 Corinthians chapter 8 and verse 2, 3rd Epistle of John verse 5, all of those Scriptures are about people taking all that they can do, living out their life as though they themselves were in the ministry full-time and gone to the mission field. I want you to imagine yourself tonight that you buy a one-way ticket to the mission field, and I'm going to send you to the remote regions of the Himalayas or to the bush of Africa. I want you to imagine the kind of life that you're going to live now. Now, why don't you go ahead and put that responsibility on you now and begin to live out that life right now, wherever you're at, whatever you're doing, and recognize that you can be like the people in 2 Corinthians chapter 8. You can be like those folks in the third epistle. You can be like those folks in Ephesians chapter 4 and verse 16, 17. They gave themselves. They went beyond their means and they impoverished themselves to take care of the things of the ministry. They gave themselves to the fellowship of the truth to take care of those who were traveling ministers, those who were going about advancing the kingdom of God, taking the gospel into all the world. They were those, as Paul said, that he wanted them to be a part of the ministry and there be fruit unto their account. No, what people do is they say, you know, we're like right now, Ann and I are getting ready to take off. And this happens with a lot of ministry because a few are doing the work of the many. The few are doing the work of the many. And here's the thing that people legislate on us. You can feel it, the spirit of it, the stinking demonic spirit of it. It's a yoke, and I'm going to make sure that it's not on anybody in this place. For me to get on an airplane, I'm 50, how old am I now? I'm 57. I'm in denial. I'm 57 years old, and I'm not going to tell you how young my wife is. But at any rate, I'm going to get on an airplane, and I'm going to fly for 30 hours again and again. And sitting in coach, your ankles will swell, your knees will inflame, and it is just terrible on your physiological condition. And then you're going to get there, and you're going to preach 2 and 3 times a day, and you're going to pour out sweat out of your body, huh? And you're going to labor like nobody on the planet works. Are you listening to me? And then get back on an airplane to go and do more damage to your body, and God's people are willing to let it be that way. That's nuts. Nobody takes it. It's not even real to them. The things of the Spirit are not even real to them. They never died with Christ Jesus. They never spent their life and turned their life over for the advancement of the kingdom of God. They hold on to their life. They live out their life. It's about their stuff and their things and what pleases them and what makes them happy and what they agree with and what they don't agree with. And it's never been conformed to the image of Christ. It's never been laying down the life. It's never been let the word of God rule over you. And so as a result, the few do the work of the many. And that's just got to stop. Yeah. Because I'm telling you right now, you can begin in a place where I begin. I begin crying out, just prayer. That's all I can really do. Oh, God, use me. I want to be used by you. I had a vision of seeing the lost standing in the darkness of the unreached people group regions when I was first saved. I mean, when I was little and I first touched with the power of God, I thought, how about all those people in the behind the iron curtain? Because when I was a little 4 or 5 year old, we just thought of that. They're behind the iron curtain, and this iron curtain nobody could get into, not even God. I mean, that was just the concept in my mind. Oh no, somebody's got to go and tell them. Somebody's got to go shine the light. When the reality of the things of the Spirit hit my soul, nothing else was important. Nothing was important. I stayed in school only because God told me to. He needed to discipline me there. I didn't go to school to go make a career. My goodness gracious, I've already been endowed, with a career to live out the life of Jesus as an ambassador of the King, to live out this wonderful realm of walking in His power and His glory. You know, when you look in Galatians chapter 6, for example, when you read there in verse 7, they that sow to the flesh shall of the flesh reap corruption, and they that sow to the Spirit shall of the Spirit reap everlasting life. That's actually in context to what you're doing with your money. Really, go back and read chapter 6. It's in context to the way that you're giving your finances to the advancement of the ministry. It's true, because God's called us to take care of the widows. He's called us to take care of the orphans. He's called us to take care of the poor among us. He's called us to take care of the local church and the traveling ministries. And I'm going to tell you right now, to begin to do that, you're going to have to get yourself a generous Holy Ghost, baptized in the Holy Ghost Pentecostal Spirit.
Yes.
To become that generous. Yes. Hallelujah. And with total abandonment, begin to be get very, very generous. Hallelujah. Because that's, I'm going to tell you right now, that is a big part to stepping into the realms of the anointing, to cooperating with the anointing. God shows us very clearly in His Word how to move with the Holy Spirit. He shows us. People say, well, I just don't feel joy. I just don't feel the flow of the anointing or whatever. Listen, I know how to get the anointing anytime you want it. With joy, you go draw water from the well. Somebody said, how do I speak to the rock? I mean, with joy. So I said, well, I need God, the Holy Ghost, give me joy. He's living in you. All you got to do, you can access it at any time. Just get a smile on your face. Begin to rejoice in the fact that your name's written in the Lamb's Book of Life. So people always begin to think, well, how can I do a crusade in Cuba? Well, guess what, folks? I'm 36 years in over here. Hello. Hello, I'm faithful. I was faithful in the prayer meetings every night. I was faithful in calling people to Bible study, whether it was at school or whether I was at work. Come on, folks. You know, don't leave the few to do the work of the many. Okay? You know, everybody's got a part to play. Hallelujah. Your children have to learn how to speak, sit up in church and pay attention and reverence the things of God, and they learn at a young age. Huh? You play patty cake with them, give them, you know, all these other things that you're just developing the wrong behavior. And too many people already got the wrong behavior built in them. They're going to have to get some discipline. Hallelujah. Yeah. Oh, and then the discipline of the Holy Ghost is the best discipline.
Yeah.
So, you know, I want you to find a place. You've got to find a place in obedience to God of living this out. Every great revival of the past started with people who began to participate with God in prayer. Because this is where you're going to grow. This is where you're going to mature. This is where you're going to learn how to talk with Father. I mean, I know that there's a barrier. You just think you don't see nothing, you don't feel nothing, you're just walking around talking into the air. I mean, that's just boring. It's hectic, but you're going to break through that. Because if you give yourself to this realm, you will break through that, and you will begin to interact with the unseen glory realm of heaven. And when you do, now you can move in the gift of faith. Now you can begin to move in a realm of faith. Hallelujah. Woo. Now you can begin to ask and begin to receive something. Now your heart begins to be captivated by God. Now you begin to bring into the church something that belongs to the Holy Ghost instead of something stinky from the human realm.
Amen. Amen.
Are you understanding me?
Yes.
The things in the realms of the Spirit, sweet smelling. Hallelujah. The things in the realm of humanity, stinky. Huh? Oh, are you with me? Do I have to prove that?
No.
Anybody need that proof on that? No, no one needs any proof on that. Smells. Woo. Smells. Smells. Capital letters. Underscored. Exclamation marks highlighted. Smells. And Father has given to us the ability. Hallelujah. To live up in this realm, but we're going to have to participate if we obey God's word, every area of our life. There are things simply Father has shown us. Do this, and this is what's going to happen. You sow into it, and you're going to reap. Hallelujah. You just keep sowing to yourself, people. In a Western civilization, a Greco-Roman culture, which is what we live in right now, That means that it's a Greekized, Romanized culture and world that we now live in, with more bent towards the Hellenism than the Romanism, but there's plenty of both to go around. And that's what you live in. That's what you call good. That's what you call right. That's what you call honorable. And it's designed by Satan, and it's a demonic trap. And Father wants to show you how to begin to live in the realms of the kingdom of God. Father wants to show you how to begin to make advances to where that all of a sudden your business serves ministry instead of ministry serving your business. And somebody says, what does that look like? Well, here's what it looks like. Everything that you do in business is a ministry power to it. And I'm not talking about some little, you know, witness of a sign that says Jesus loves you in the back of your head as you're walking around, you know, your building or whatever. I'm talking about the power of God bringing forth fruit. I'm talking about people getting saved. I'm talking about people getting established in the church. I mean, look around. Look around. I couldn't handle it if I did not have people, I did not have fruit, if I was unfruitful in the knowledge of God and did not bring anybody into a place of commitment to the Lord Jesus Christ where they were established in the building. That means unfruitful right there. I would not get all feeling bad about myself. I'd start touching heaven. I would get passionate. I would just look, oh God, I just thank you so much for your goodness. And oh, I just thank you that you've helped me to finally get past just going to sleep when I get home from work. And now I'm actually being able to pray a little bit. Suddenly, you would begin to recognize the call of God upon your life and the lethargy that's there. The unfruitfulness is there. And I'm going to tell you right now, you'll get down to business. And when you begin to get down to business with God, you're going to get yourself some results. You're going to get yourself a divine impartation that is going to work a supernatural result. Somebody said, well, I've been fishing all night and caught nothing. Yeah, now why don't you start moving under the master's word? Now, why don't you start moving under the anointing of the Holy Ghost? All you got is proof that you're not moving by the master's word. All you do is got proof that you're not moving under the anointing of the Holy Ghost. And then when you come to church, you're all distracted and it's hard for you to enter in. And there's another proof for you. But now all that's happening is the pastor's picking on you. No, the pastor's looking for somebody that will step up so that the few don't have to do the work of the many. Hallelujah. Because I am determined. I am here for one purpose. I have a bigger call of God upon my life than to just stay in one nation. I'm here for one purpose, and that is to raise up radical, Holy Ghost, soul-winning, nation-shaking people. Period. Hallelujah. That's it. And if you don't want that and you don't like that, you're in the wrong church. You're going to be disappointed because I'm going to be on you. I'm going to be reading the right act to you. I'm going to be giving you the list of why you're not walking right with God. Amen.
Amen.
There's just too many things that you can do. If you would begin to get your life placed in to a realm in which God, the Holy Ghost, has declared to us, which Jesus pronounced. He said, all authority is given unto me in heaven and earth. He said, go therefore. Yes. Now you've got to see yourself going. You've got to see yourself going in the various different contexts of Jerusalem, of Judea, of Samaria, and the uttermost parts of the earth. One of the most important things to do is to see that feeding into and central to the purpose that the local church is functioning in. To where that you are so under that mandate that you are hooked together with what the church is doing. And when we say, listen, we need to fast and pray, you fasting and praying. When we say we need to hit the streets, you hitting the streets. And that you're not just doing it out of form and faithfulness, but you're doing it out of an anointing of the Holy Ghost where you can be fruitful. You send 10 people out on the street, one of them's baptized in the Holy Ghost, that one will get souls. The other 9 will get nothing. They will knock on, the other 9 might knock on 100 times more doors than the one. But the one will have 100 times more fruit than the 9. Just the way it is. God, don't go. I'll take care of them. Okay. You know, it's just disappointing to me, okay? I want you, listen, I don't like moving in and out of the meeting. This is too important. I don't like all of the stuff going on, all the distractions going on. You know what? You know the thing, you know, I was just saying this the other day. You know, find people in the meeting who don't want to grow and mature and let them take care of the kids. They don't even like what I'm saying. Let them take care of the kids. Somebody said, don't do that because the kid's going to turn out like them. I go, oh, good thought. So you can't even take care of the kids in this house. You know what I'm saying? You can't even work offline in this house. unless you're full of the Holy Ghost, because we're not going to partner with it. Are you listening to me? I mean, you barely clean the bathrooms in this place unless you got, are you with me? Unless you hooked up with what we're saying and what we're doing. Hallelujah. So I want you to see yourself. I want you to get yourself a one-way ticket to go fulfill the will of God. Yeah. To go stop living out your life about your new cooker, about your new, you know, your new blender, about your new juicer, about your new whatever, and you need another this and you need another that, and you're hoping for something other than that you have right now. This purely earthly and natural. Come on. Come on. You're not going to be doing that in the bush of Africa. You're not going to be doing that in the Himalaya. There are so many missionaries right now that are barely empowered to do what they're doing. Because the few are doing the work of the many. I'm telling you, dear people, I pray in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, you'll get yourself about the kingdom of God and you'll understand how that begins first and foremost to feed into your responsibility in the local church to bring something that is right out of the realms of the Holy Ghost. Bring your heart and your affection, starting with just your attention, starting with just respect, starting with just the basic honor of those things that are right and godly within your responses to people around you, and especially to the authority in the house. Because if you don't honor the authority in the house, you shame and father. Amen. Just period. You shame and father. You dishonoring him. People say, I'm on my way to heaven. Not disrespecting and dishonoring God, you're not. I don't care how much Bible you know. I don't care how much money you've given in the church. I don't care how many years you've been in the ministry or whatever. Or in the building, or whatever. You're not going to heaven. Dishonoring God. True. Disrespecting the Holy Ghost. Because your heart's far from them. Your words might be right. Your mouth might be right. Huh? You're just a wolf in sheep clothing. Are you listening to me? Yeah. Somebody said, how can you tell the difference between a wolf in sheep clothing? Look at their tracks. Are you listening to me? Yeah. Hallelujah. That goes over good with the hunters. Just look at the tracks. Where they come from. Oh, look at that. Big difference between a paw and a hoof. Big difference. Hallelujah. Bakadasha Neapaya. Listen, I'm getting after you tonight. I'm getting you straightened out to give you a word here in a minute. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You can't take the correction. You can't have the peaceable fruits of righteousness either. Hallelujah. People run, duck, and hide as soon as God gets to speaking. It just shows that they're living in shame and sin and iniquity. Huh? They go run and duck and hide as soon as God gets to talking, just like Adam, because of the shame and the sin and the iniquity. And they don't want to change. They don't know how to change. We're here teaching you how to change. It about time. And most of the people here tonight, you're part of this ministry and you've been in this ministry. And it's after such a long time as this is, you need to get busy doing something more than you're doing. God's about maturing people and bringing forth a spiritual maturity in people's life. You know, I can hear these little things, you know, little compromising things. Just love on them and bless them, you know, for what little they do. I was looking at that verse of scripture. You know, as soon as I get like a suggestion like that, I mean, I go to looking. Be blessed and satisfied for whatever little thing they do. I couldn't find it. I got other stuff, though, like correct them, get after them. You tell them this is what I've supposed purpose for them to do. See, I'm not talking about little peripheral details here tonight. I'm talking about the very central core to the reality of who we are and what we're doing, why we were born again and baptized in the Holy Ghost and fire, why God gave us the Holy Spirit, why these things, the wonderful things of the Holy Spirit, are revealed in our life. And if you don't participate with that, there's not going to be the activity of the Holy Ghost in your life. And if there's not the activity of the Holy Ghost in your life, you're never going to mature. And we're never going to have what we had in the past. There's not going to be a chance that America will have anybody who grabs a hold of the things of the Spirit and begins through prayer and intercession and passion lay hold on what Father has given to us. Somebody said, oh, prayer is not my gifting. That's the biggest nonsense, you know, where people come up with these ideas is certainly not from the Bible. Are you listening to me? Because he's called every one of us to have prayer and supplication in the Holy Ghost. Amen. With all prayer and supplication. He commanded every one of us to be continually filled with the Spirit and be responsible for the state of this world. People are constantly being tossed to and fro because they don't want to live out God's life. They want to live out their life. Hallelujah. I'm so glad that I've never had to mandate this in my house. I never had to mandate it in my house. We just modeled it and did it, and everybody else followed through. Huh? Because we let God, the Holy Ghost, take care of it. We didn't have to force people, tie their arm around their back, put them in a headlock, say, you got to do this. You listening to me? Primarily because we fought the battle in prayer instead of the arm of flesh. We understood how to take a hold of God so that it could be in our house. Hallelujah. I'm having the church the same thing I have in my house. It's for me and my house. We'll serve God. Everybody has the right to choose whatever they want to choose and do whatever they want to do. But it's for me and my house, we'll serve God. And as far as I'm concerned, for me and my church, we're going to serve the living God. We're going to walk in the Word of God. And I'm not going to tolerate all the other stuff. I'm not tolerating it. Because I'm dad in the house. I don't care if you're 30 years older than I am. I'm dad in the house. That's the way Papa set it up. Hallelujah. I'm not your brother in that sense. Huh? I'm not your co-laborer in that sense. You need to get the things organized properly in your head. Hallelujah. Once you get them organized, then we can move on from there. Amen. Hallelujah. And that's the problem that is going on across churches, in churches all across America. People in America don't know how to follow their leadership. Everybody's so brilliant. They're bright and shining stars, just like Satan. Because of their own brightness and intellect, they are lifted up. Huh? And they didn't have any glory to turn into corruption. Their corruption just went to deeper corruption. Huh? So we're going to have to understand, what am I going to do here? Hallelujah. Hallelujah. So we're getting ready to go, and we're getting ready to move into something good here. Of course, everything we've been doing already is good. And you know, everything we've been doing already is good. Your prayer time, your life, your moments, your money. It better be God's. Or you could do one of two things. You make your time and your money God's, or you get yourself a one-way ticket to the Himalayas right now. We'll set you up. You get yourself a one-way ticket somewhere to go preach. Because I'm telling you right now, if you haven't touched heaven and the anointing now for Jerusalem, you know you're never going to. So we're going to have to get you out there in a place of complete desperation. Then you'll touch God. Amen. One amen. And everybody else is silent. I'm giving you one or two choices. I'm not playing no games here. I'm not playing no games. We're sorting it out tonight. Tonight we're sorting it out. Tonight. Hallelujah. Come on, Satan. You do one or two things. You get your time and your finances and your life into the kingdom of God, or you get yourself a one-way ticket to the mission field tonight. We will get you all squared away. Or I'll let you plan for a month. That gives you time to sell your stuff. Hallelujah. We want you to make heaven. We want to see you. Then come back in 20 years, man, we'll have somebody matured in the things of the Spirit. Hallelujah. Woo! You sit around here doing what you've done, and in 20 years you're going to be more of a headache than you are now. Huh? Are you listening to me? I'm on Jacob Abasaya. Pat preached a sermon the other night, get this dummy off my back. He had this dummy on his back, you know, and he's preaching, get this dummy off my back. I mean, come on. There's too many things. There's too many people to reach and to just babysit. You know what? The Pentecostal nursery. Huh? Are you listening to me? Huh? We're here to raise you up. Listen, God has commanded me to perfect you. God has commanded me to build you up. Come on, now get you strong. And the only I know how to get perfected, and I know how to get strong. And it's nothing that I'm going to give you. It's what I'm going to lead you to do that the Word of God declares and the Spirit of the living God supplies. Hallelujah. Woo! Hallelujah. Are you ready?
Yeah.
Are you ready? Yeah. Are you ready? Yeah. Hallelujah. Well, if your heart's right, if what I've said you have received, and that means your heart is right. And you're not sitting there, you're not holding back. You said, yes, Lord, when I said it. One or two things. You said, yes, Lord, I will. I'll go. Because I'm telling you right now, you already said that. It's just that you slow on the curve for thinking. You slow on the curve of just understanding some real simple stuff. Hallelujah. That you no longer live.
Yeah.
That you're bought with a price and you belong to God to live His life. Okay, that's all we're saying here tonight. And you just fooled yourself and allowed yourself to be deceived because you made the Word conform to you instead of you conforming to the Word. You made the life of Jesus conform to your image. My goodness, that'd be a terrible thought. That you conforming to His image. Hallelujah. Are you listening to me? You said, I'm doing this. I'm in. Hallelujah. Rafaya. Rafaya. Musata. Rafaya. Musata. Rafaya. Musata. Kinemashi. Rafaya. Musata. Kinemashika. Understand. Father is breaking off yokes, deception, lies, falsehoods. Right now, He's doing it. Frafi don sanaya. Is hepato kaniapa. Is heaven speaking through me to speak right to you beyond my ability to even articulate the will of God, but to deal with things in your spirit that your mind might blockade if I was to say it with your understand words that you could understand. But I'm sneaking around your understanding, going right to the problem. Hallelujah. Woo! Ha, come on, guy, I don't know, shake up. Yes, I'm going to tell you, I believe with all of my heart that God will raise up within this ranks of this people great anointed ministries. Whole legacies of great anointed ministries. Children's children is children's children. Hallelujah. For the next however long till Jesus comes, maybe 200 years, maybe 300 years. I don't know. But I do know that I've purposed to be a part of going into all the world. I've purposed myself from the day that I gave my life to the Lord Jesus to do Jerusalem, to do Judea, to do Samaria, to do the uttermost parts of the world. And I used to just be so, you know, burdened in my spirit. How do I get to the world? We've been doing Jerusalem now for 5 months. It's time to go to Judea. It's time to go to Samaria. It's time to go to the uttermost parts of the world. And I didn't know how to do it. But I didn't let myself get frustrated because I found a place of prayer. Woo. I found a place of the realms of heaven so flooding my soul. I found such an effectiveness in God. I found something going on in a relationship with the Lord to where that everything about my life was completely in His control and under His authority. And I was so content and so satisfied and knew that He was going to do it. And He was going to go beyond all that I could think or ask. And all I needed to do was just continue to go at whatever I was doing. And it wasn't a task for me. It was a delight. It was never a task. It's never a task to be involved in ministry. It's never been a task to take everything that I have, everything we can scrape together in finances and dump it into the vision and then and stretch ourselves so far beyond any capacity of human ability because that's where you step in the divine. People want to just play it. They want to play a human game with God and do what they can calculate, what they're certain that they can, you know, spend, what they're certain that they can do. You're never going nowhere in God like that. God's called us to do, not to live in the natural, but to live in the supernatural. Not to live in the realms of our human ability, but to live in the realms of divine power and ability. And He's waiting for us to agree with Him. I'm going to tell you right now, I'd rather let every man down than to let God down. And Father's going to see that for me. I'd rather not pay a single bill on the planet than to not pay my bills with heaven. Hallelujah. And I didn't get many amens there because most people aren't even there. They aren't even there. They don't even know how to think heavenly. You're so captivated by a world system designed by a demon power. So indebted up over your head. Then encouraging other people, go get in debt too. Give me a break. If that debt is not about advancing the kingdom of God, that's hellacious. Amen. That's right out of hell. Amen. That's all it is more bondage for you. Your debt needs to be about advancing the kingdom of God. And there's too many ways to do it. There's too many things to be done. There's too many people to be reached. Amen. I'm going to tell you, there are so many things right here. And many churches don't even have an understanding of how to begin to participate with an enlarged vision. They don't even understand how to begin to participate with an enlarged vision. But you've got it handed to you right now. Amen. I mean, we're not asking you to get on an airplane with us and go. We're not asking you to risk your life. We're asking you to send us. And we're asking you to do more than just send us by finances. We're asking you to send us by prayer and by fasting. But until you get a passion, until something of heaven is born in your heart about the commission of the Lord, you won't do it. You'll forget. You'll forget. You'll forget. You'll forget. Why? Because you're busy with your stuff. If you weren't busy with your stuff, you wouldn't forget. Huh? Because you'd be busy with heaven. It'd be number one thing on your heart. Number one thing on your soul. Number one thing on your spirit. Huh? When you're on vacation, you don't forget about vacation. You're on vacation. It's what's happening. Hallelujah. Come on, people. Kana moshi kata bahaya. I want to breathe this into you tonight. I want you to be able to see what's right there in front of you, that the enemy's been blinding you to see how to participate. I want you to understand, I mean, we're not only doing the things that we're doing internationally and nationally and on the Mission Training Center, what we're doing to build something that is going to last for, you know, till Jesus comes to send more missionaries into the unreached people groups than anyone else on the planet, than ever has been done before. We're going to do it. Why? Because of the network. I was just having FaceTime with Sudeep in Norway today, and we were talking about all the great connections that God has been putting together and how it's enlarged on a governmental level and what we can go to do right now because of those connections. Because of someone sitting in Parliament that has now connected all the churches together, and he's like, just ask. Sudeep says, when is Pastor Mark returning to Nepal? I said, tell him I'm coming. I'm on my way. Wow. He, you know, why are you away so long? Because, see, for them, a great awakening came to their nation when we came there. I mean, to hear, it's like, you know, I remember hearing Tommy Hicks, how that Tommy Hicks went to Argentina and it was turned upside down. He come back to America and nobody believed him. 20 people would come to his meeting. It was such a heartsick thing. There was such a great anointing upon his life and nobody could get the vision to send Tommy. It broke him. It busted him. Because a few are doing the work of the many. Because the many are preoccupied with their own stuff and pointing a finger of accusation because an antichrist spirit has more power and influence on them than they realize. And rather than advancing the kingdom, they're stopping the kingdom. And they don't even know it. While they're praising God, worshiping Him, quoting Bible, leading a Bible study. Listen to me. I want to get you out of the risk of missing heaven and get you into the risk of living heaven. Hallelujah. I want to get you out of the risk of missing heaven and get you into the risk of living heaven. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And I can see in some of your eyes, hallelujah. I like looking on the front row here and seeing this fire in your belly and Holy Ghost in your eyes. I'm telling you, it's a blessing to me. Hallelujah. Katanane, I want to be able to see it all the way to the back row. Hallelujah. I see you, Josh. I see you, Josh. I see you, man. I see you. The anointing of the Holy Ghost is on you. Ain't nobody being left out that can't live without it. Anybody who can live without it, you just planning your retirement. My goodness gracious. We're going, hallelujah. Hallelujah. Ain't no such thing as planning out your retirement. Praise God. I'm dying preaching. Amen. We get too old and decrepit to move around. We'll get somebody to carry us to some place. We'll die as a martyr in Jesus' name. Amen. We'll just lay there on our cot preaching. Hallelujah. I want you to get it tonight. I want you to make the commitment. I want you to get consecrated in this thing tonight. Hallelujah. I want you to give beyond. I want you to do what the examples are in 2 Corinthians chapter 8. Not only to give within your means, but impoverish yourself taking care of the ministry. Why? Because you're wearing the responsibility of the many. Because now you get to go with us. You get to go with us. I want you to go with us. I want you to go with us to where it's bigger to you. I don't want you to just miss some great event. And it's like, oh, yeah, they went and, yeah, they did something. And I don't know, but it was pretty significant. They got a YouTube. But rather be in it and understand, like, and come to me because you're so in it. You're just like, you know, Pastor, I just got this so, like, there's such a burden for Nepal. Is there something I could go and do there? And I would say, absolutely. Been waiting for you to ask. Been waiting for the anointing to be so big in your life that you stirred enough to ask. Because if I got to ask you, it ain't nothing. It ain't gone nowhere. It ain't reality. You know what I'm saying to you. People, I want you to be a part of what God's doing. You've got to understand. You got before you get a part to be a part of what God is doing, you personally have got to get stamped with a heavenly vision. And you've got to agree, sorry, Samu, you have to agree to participate with what your assignment is. And quit acting like it's not your assignment. Your assignment is to go in all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. It's your assignment. Go. Now. Quit pretending. Huh? It ain't about workplace evangelism. God didn't say, oh, you, I'm gonna do you the power from on high that you may have workplace evangelism. I didn't say that. Not even close. What do you do? Oh, I just got to workplace evangelism. Well, when are you going to do the rest of the gospel? When are you going to get the rest of the vision? How long you had that vision? Oh, 50 years. Well, you're never going to get it because you're rooted now, man. You're so deceived on your own self and your own gospel that you're never going to hear the gospel. Huh? It's about how you do what God said to do. Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, the uttermost parts of the world. Go ye into all the world and preach the gospel. Just everybody who's in the ministry, who's called the apostle, prophet, evangelist, pastor, and teacher, special gifted people. No. And namu se yada bahane. No. No. Hallelujah. Anybody who's been baptized in the Holy Ghost and power, that was why you were baptized in the Holy Ghost and power. Amen. So anybody says, we say, you baptized in the Holy Ghost and power, and you raise your hand, you just said, I was baptized in the Holy Ghost and power to go into Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, and the uttermost parts of the world. Right. That's what you just said. You said, I agreed to a covenant, to obey a covenant, to participate with God, and those are the only people that develop and mature spiritually. Everybody else is just grunting. Grunting out little spiritual expressions from time to time. Little grunts. Little grunts and huh? Little grunts and mumbles. Come on, man. Come on, man. Yes. Come on. A glorious church. Yes, a glorious
Father.
Church.
Yes, Father.
With the manifestation of the Spirit being made fully developed in every person's life. Yes. Where when we begin to worship and sing, people aren't standing around looking at this thing and that thing and organizing their household. It's time to be called away into heaven, begin to prophesy by the Spirit. God is Spirit, and you must worship Him in spirit. There are many people come to church and they've never worshiped God. They've been in church every service that has ever been in their hometown, and they never one time worshiped God. Because all they did was brought a human offering. They never entered into the realms of the Holy Ghost. They never even knew there was a Holy Ghost. They heard about Him, but they never knew by revelation. Tonight I got some revelation for you. I'm laying on the sioloho. I'm a laytani. I'm a rosutani bekaya. I'm laying on a sital on a buretai. I'm laying out a maserenea. I'm laying out a dividing line between those who are going to receive these things tonight and those who are not going to receive these things tonight. Hallelujah. Maripasatarabakaya. Murababasataranea. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Murabasataya. Mandaribaya. Hallelujah. We're raising these girls to do great signs and wonders. And they're not going to go just because we're praying they're going to go. They're going to go because we go. Because the anointing is upon us. Hallelujah. And because we're not going to let it up. We're not going to let up. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Okay. You ready? Everybody's in agreement? Everybody been baptized in the Holy Ghost and fire here? That means that you, everything about your life belongs to the work and the burden of the ministry. And that it means you're either the one going or you're the one sending. And sending is definitely both you giving yourself to prayer, because I'm telling you, prayer changes, rearranges everything about us, empowers, opens up doors, shuts doors, binds things, looses things. Hallelujah. And you're not gonna mature. I mean, I don't want a bunch of 6-month-old prayer warriors praying for me. Goodness gracious. You're gonna mature in prayer by giving yourself to prayer. I mean, I tell you right now, we take the cows. Listen to me. Somebody said, don't relate me to a cow. Well, humble yourself. And we number the cows. We grade the cows. We grade them. Some of them, if they're too skinny, we grade them on a low grade. Why? We grade them on a 1 because they need to get fattened up. They fat enough, grade them on a 5, whatever. You with me? And so if we just started lining you up and grading you, you know how we would grade you? By the way you pray. By the way you talk to the Father. We'll grade you. 1 to 5. Hallelujah. So I thought it will be graded. Well, why don't you want the floodlight of heaven shine upon your soul? What is it that you're so insecure about? What is it that you're hiding? Why is it that pride of life has such a hold on you? You don't want somebody to get in your life and evaluate you and help you understand where you're weak and where you're short and help supply the lack that is in your life. To come impart things to you. You can't impart anything to anybody unless somebody's willing to receive. And if somebody doesn't know what they need, they're never going to receive because they don't know what they need. You're bringing something they're not buying. You know, I'm trying to sell you the riches of heaven, and you're not in the market. You're in the market. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. That's the right way to do it. That's the right way to do it. You say, I'm in the market. I speak out faith. Hallelujah. I speak out the word. Hallelujah. I speak out the agreement with God. I agree with God. I agree with God by what I say. Hallelujah. I agree with God by what I do. That is where faith begins to be made manifest. Praise God. Hallelujah. Woo! Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Open up your Bibles. Open up your Bibles to Mark 8:18. Everybody open your Bibles to Mark 8:18. Kalamon Sataya. I'm getting ready to give you something. Hey. I said I'm getting ready to give you something. No. I'm gonna give you something worth more than $1 billion. Hallelujah. 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 Are you looking with me in Mark 8:18? And so the disciples didn't get it. They didn't get it. Jesus is talking to them out of the realms of the spirit, and all they can hear is, oh no, he's talking about we need to eat dinner. You know, most people are just like right down to there. What we gonna eat? What we gonna eat? What we gonna eat? What we eating? What we wearing? What we wearing? What we eating? And that is the mentality, that is the stretch of their wisdom and from which they confine all of their intellectual, you know, greatness. What we eating? What we wearing? Are you listening to me? And listen to what Jesus said. It's beautiful. Having eyes? Can't you see? Huh? Are you listening? Listen to me. Huh? Yeah. Having ears? Can't you hear? And don't you remember? Say this. Say see.
See.
Hear.
Hear.
Remember.
Remember.
We're impaired. We're impaired. We always forgetting. We forgot what we saw. We forgot what we heard. Well, in fact, we didn't even see what there was there to see. And we didn't even hear what there was there to hear. And we didn't remember after it was done. And that's really bad. Okay? And it wasn't something that was mistakable. This is 5,000 people, not counting men, not counting women and children, that got fed off of a few loaves and a few fishes. And how many basketfuls took you up? Well, praise God, they got that right. 12. They got it. They remembered. But it had to be recalled to their attention. Their mind was not in a realm of the kingdom of God. They had not yet hooked up with spirit knowledge. They had not yet hooked up with where Jesus was at. Praise God, they were a far stretch ahead of the majority of the Pentecostal church because they left everything and had forsaken all to go follow Jesus. Far stretch ahead. But they weren't getting it. Huh? Having eyes, can't you see? Don't you remember the 4,000? You know, it's just listen to me. Woo-hoo! I'm going to get ready. Well, I'm going to bring it down to here in a little bit. Just hang on a second. But listen to me. It's just like this. Israel. This is us. This is us, baby. Listen to me. Israel. And I'm going to tell you, I'm going to have this. I'm going to have greater works. I'm going to have signs and wonders and miracles. Israel. Listen to me. Israel is living under a pillar of fire by night, walking around going, where's God? And where is our provision? And where is the promise of our inheritance? Huh? Fire God burning over top of them. Fire God burning over top of them. Huh? Cloud by day, manna falling. Where is our provision? Where is this promise of this unseen God that's going to do all these things for us? First and foremost, they didn't have eyes to see. all the signs and all the wonders and all the miracles. And they're going, well, I don't see any miracles. I don't see any signs. I don't see any wonders. What makes you better than us, Moses? Well, his face is shining with radiant power and glory. That would be a starting place. Are you with me? These are the most intellectual. These are the brightest and the best. Where? What makes you better than us? Well, he did lift up the rod and the sea parted. None of these things. He did speak to the rock and the water came out. But where? What makes you better than us? No ability to see in the things of the Spirit. No knowledge of the Spirit. No revelation of heaven. No reality of God. Only earthly interests. Even though they're handpicked by God and a covenant people the Father has devoted himself to, who says, you're mine. And because you're mine, you're holy. You're mine, you're my possession, you're holy. But they refused to see. And it came to the point in time that after such a God dealing with them for more than 1,000 years, right at about 1,000, right at about 800 years, God dealing with them. Finally, the prophet Isaiah said, seeing, you shall not see. And hearing, you shall not hear. And your heart will not be able to understand the ways of the Spirit and the ways of God and the movings of God, because your hearts ye have hardened and your eyes you've closed. And you've been unwilling to listen. And then Jesus came along and he confirmed it after over and again declaring the goodness of God, saying, I'm the door. Come step in. Look at what it looks like. You don't need to be sick. You don't need to be in the position spiritually that you're in, or diseased or poverty stricken or without God in your life. They refused to hear. They had their own things to do. And he reconfirmed what Isaiah said. And then came along Paul, and Paul himself also, towards the end of his ministry, once again reconfirmed what God said. But here, I'm here to tell you tonight that the Father is going to do something for you. Because Father has told us to continue to pray, and I've continued to pray for you. I've continued to pray for this church for many years. And I know that my prayers that have been lifted up towards heaven have been heard. I know Father has marked me. I know he's marked my word. I know that my prayers is incense offered before him. A prayer is so important to him. Prayer is so valuable to him. Prayer is so sacred to him. Prayer is so important to him that he holds it as that which he would want to keep and possess forever. And when it's time to worship him, the censer is open and my prayers, the prayers of Mark Spitzbergen, come out before the Lord of armies, the Lord of hosts. And I prayed, oh God, let this church have the spirit of wisdom and revelation and the knowledge of you. Let them have spirit knowledge. Let them have spirit knowledge. Let them leave the earthly behind. Let them leave the sensual behind. Let them leave the intellectual realm behind. Let their eyes be open so that they can begin to interact with heaven, so that they begin to see and understand the exceeding greatness of your power. I tell you right now, I'm going to say this. Every one of you in this building, and especially if you've been here for more than a year, should already be able to quote that verse of scripture in Ephesians 1, 18 through 23, because I quote it so much. You should already have it by memory just because you've heard it so much. To where it becomes the cry of your heart. Because Father tries the reins and searches the hearts of men. He sees those who cry out before him, who seek him earnestly, who hunger to know him, who wait upon him, who are there desperate for him. And he sees those who are willing to just be silent and go on whatever it is that they are willing to go on with. And much of it is not the heavenly vision. It does not have anything to do with reaching Jerusalem and Judea and Samaria and the uttermost parts of the earth. It has really nothing to do with going into all the world and preaching the gospel. Not as the foremost, not as that which is the most important thing. We bring to God a voluntary offering to the Father of our own free will. We set it apart and it becomes a devoted thing. And God said, anybody who gives a devoted thing can never take it back. It can never be redeemed. It's devoted. And to take it back only needs results and be cutting off, to be cut off. It's a devoted thing. Your life is a devoted thing. And Father in His long suffering, oh God, He's so good. Father in His long suffering and His mercy deals with us, pleads with us, stretches forth His arms, crying out to us. And many people's hearts are really challenged when it's offering time and we're talking about the ministry and all of a sudden you start calculating what all you want for yourself and what all you're giving to God and don't even know that you're processing on the wrong realm with the wrong view of things. You have an earthly perspective and not a heavenly one. You have a natural realm of thinking and not a spirit knowledge. And Father's here tonight to change your processing. I'm telling you right now, you begin to give everything up and you begin to walk away from everything to follow the Lord Jesus Christ and you inherit it all. Amen. You inherit it all. You inherit like Abraham did the worlds to come. Amen. You inherit beyond what Abraham did. Well, in many respects, we can't inherit beyond what Abraham did other than what we could do right now in this life. In the next life, our inheritance will be the same with Abraham because his inheritance is all in Christ Jesus and he won't be left out and he may have actually more there. But right now, we actually have an opportunity to live greater than Abraham did because we've been baptized in the Holy Ghost and power to live out a life fully revealing God's power and glory on the earth like no other generation or time period ever had the opportunity. And we're willing to give our life for that which profits nothing. We're willing to put our value into that which moth and rust consumes and destroys. It's because we're ignorant, we're blinded. Having eyes, we cannot see the spiritual realm. We only see the natural. Having ears, we cannot hear the spiritual realm. We only hear that which is of interest and value to us on an earthly realm, in a natural realm. And we can't remember all the great things that God has done. I believe one of the things that takes people's interaction, relationship with God to a whole nother level is where we just begin to get thankful for what God has done. I thank God for the Abiding Place Ministry. As much as I thank God for Jesus. I thank God for the Holy Ghost. I thank God that I'm breathing. I thank God for the pillow. I thank God that my name's written in the Lamb's Book of Life. I tell you right now, I just named a whole bunch of things better than a glory cloud over top of me and a pillar by fire by night and manna to eat by day. I know I don't got much response here because maybe you didn't hear what I said. But I just said something greater than having a pillar of fire by night and a cloud by day. Having eyes we see not and ears we hear not. Neither do we understand. That's why it's not important to us. That's why it's not as big of a deal to us. That's why when we're alone and we're calculating and we're thinking as we compare ourselves with others out of false motives that we haven't done this and we haven't done that and we don't have this and we don't have that and yet all around us is the blessings of God. All around us is the provision of God. All around us is the mercy of God. All around us is the protection of God where He daily loads us and we can't see it. But then even beyond that, that our name's written in the Lamb's Book of Life, that the Holy Ghost is with me and in me. I'm telling you right now, you start getting thankful. You start getting thankful for what God has given you, that the Holy Ghost is with you and in you. I'm going to tell you right now, you're going to get a breakthrough from the natural into the spiritual. And when it becomes a reality, well, faith begins to work. Faith begins, spirit knowledge begins to work. Then you, hallelujah. Then you say to the sun and the moon, listen to me. Then you say to the rock, water, come out. Then you begin to move in faith, hallelujah. Then you begin to take personal responsibility. Say, no, you're not going without me taking care of you. I'm doing something. Amen. There's very few people that ever come to me over the past 35 years when I've been going doing ministry saying, look, you're not going by yourself. I'm taking care of you. What is it that you, I want not just what you need, what's some extra. Now, if they were going, it might be a little different. You listen, I know we got real silent here, reflective. It's just a reality. I'm talking to you about a new concept of your life. The hub of that new concept of your life must be that you are the part of the family. That you have the inheritance, that you're an heir of God and a co-inheritor with Jesus. That you're living out the sonship, the endowment. Not to do your own stuff. Because, I mean, I don't care what you say. Everything that you need to be doing must be in the context and the vision of the local church. People going off giving money to this one and that one and the other one, you don't know how much of that squandered. I mean, I know the inside story of where literally hundreds of millions of dollars are stacked up and people are committing adultery and doing all kinds of other things and people sending more money. Wow, the local church goes without the ability to do the things that God has purposed and made big on their own heart. And the pastor, the men around them, never have stepped into a realm of faith to step over top of everybody. I stepped over top of everybody a long time ago. And that ain't the way it's supposed to be. But that's basically why the few has done the work of the many, because if we had to go with the many, we'd be stuck. You just got to step over top of it. Just run right open. Just go. With total abandonment. People, I'd rather risk everything for God. Hallelujah. Than risk not making heaven. People are playing a dicey game there. Saying that they don't have to go into all the world and preach the gospel. Somehow they're going to imagine how they're doing it. Why? Because you threw a couple of dollars away? No. Because a couple of dollars don't mean nothing if your heart's not in it. If you're not going, this is going proxy for me, Pastor. This is going proxy for me. And I want you to know, this everything I got is all I have. And I would go and I want to go and I'm sowing into going one day. Because that's got to be the heart. Can't be here, you just go do my work for me. Huh? You're my whipping boy. Here, go do my work for me. Go take my whipping. Go do my suffering for me. Go bear my cross for me. Go lay down my life for me. Uh-uh. That's nonsense. You got to get your heart in this thing. You got to get your heart in this thing. That's more than skin in it. That's your heart, your passion, your person. Hallelujah. I'm telling you, people, I'm not asking you to do something I'm not doing. I'm not telling you to go do all these things. I'm just sitting here laughing while you go. I'm over here. Listen, come on, people. I'm leading by example. I'm telling you right now, you hear the passion, the cries of my heart. I don't sit around trying to make this stuff up. It pours out of me. Hallelujah. Amen. I don't have to stress out about what we're going to preach about. I preach every night. Man, I'm not going to run out of the anointing. Hallelujah. I got some of this 7 days a week. Praise God. A couple times a day. Hallelujah. And we want you to have it. That's what Father has for you. And that's where you're going to develop. We create things for ourselves and responsibilities and commitments so that evening and morning at noon, we pray and we cry aloud. Yes. Not whisper.
Yes. Amen.
Whisper a prayer in the morning. That's nonsense. Cry aloud. Yes. No whisper. That's like doing the opposite of what God said. Isn't that about right? Whisper a prayer in the morning. Whisper a prayer at noon. Whisper a prayer in the evening. Keep your heart in tune. That's nonsense. That song wasn't born in revival. That was born in a dead church trying to accommodate their lethargy and their lukewarmness, trying to make their lukewarmness fit God's red hot. Hallelujah. Once again, I'm happy to support you. I just told a person the other day, I said, listen, I need somebody to go to India now. I need somebody to commit to go to India for 3 months. But I want somebody who's got an anointing. And I want that anointing's got to be displayed right here in this house first. And if you don't got enough anointing to display in this house, I'm not sending you to go make a wreck of things. Huh? God makes us able ministers of the new covenant by the Holy Ghost, and I'm looking for you to start moving in the anointing. Hallelujah. So I told somebody that moving in the anointing, I said, I need somebody to go to India for me for 3 months right now. Because I've got two major regions in India. They want to do crusades, and the Lord's forbidden me to do crusades with them until, and they want to even pay for it, until the thing is sorted out and it's developed. And I need, and there's a whole huge region. There's this one group in India. I mean, I told them, you can't do crusade for me? No. They said, no, well, we're going to get together at least 3,000 people. I said, we're taking care of everything, you know. It's just amazing because these are poor people and not in the big cities, in the remote regions of India. They've been desperate, calling me to come for the past 3 to 4 years. And I said, no, I can't come. And then the Lord spoke to me, you go. And so I It was beautiful. I sent them a message, a Facebook message, says I'm coming, and they're like, you know, it was beautiful. I mean, it was just shouts of hallelujah. We just all fell out under the anointing over here. We're all out under the power of God. Hallelujah. Power of God's moving so strong, we'll have to get back with you later when we can function again, kind of thing, you know? Beautiful. People hungry and desperate. People hungry and desperate. Sudeep was telling me, he said, I quit the 3-year Bible program. I said, why did you quit the 3-year Bible school? He said, because all the guys come out from the bush, they get here, they're flowing in the anointing, and then they become all heady. And they stop flowing in the anointing. See, I'm not having nothing to do with that. I'm going to have them for 3 months, and again, I'm going to get them right back out there. All they do is just become a bunch of brainiacs. I'll sit around and talk about what the Bible did and what somebody did so long ago, and so sit around and just spew out scriptures to one another and talk about what the eternal world and perfect world is going to look like, what the devil did when he did it, wonder what happened when no one told him, and all the secret things that no one's revealed, wonder what that happened back in that period of time, and do nothing in the Holy Ghost. I said, I'm done with it. I said, that sounds like a good plan to me. I said, I know. I told him, I said, I can feel your pain. I can feel your pain. Pastoring's not for everyone. Hallelujah. You've got to have a willingness to get people up, off of their, you know, whatever it is, comfort zones, whatever it is that they've settled out to do. You know, you're going to have to discipline the house. And if people want to be all heady and high-minded and rebellious, or they want to be so sensitive they don't want to, you know, they're stubborn. They don't want to listen. They just want to get hurt. They want to get hurt and offended instead of built up, you know, corrected and built up. Huh? Or I could say hurt and offended instead of instructed and built up. Huh? It happens all the time. Man, you get a bunch of hurt and wounded people in the church because you're preaching too hard. Now we need to get somebody in here who preaches softer. And then what are you going to be? Huh? What then will you justify your do-nothing position with? You know? We're not hurting a bit anymore. We're not challenged. Are you with me? Oh, masekedi barahaya. I need people to go. I got places. I got to have people go do stuff. We got pitadoro sevreteya. Cuba's open. I've got to have people to be in Cuba. I've got to have people in Cuba. I need people in Cuba, on the ground in Cuba from June till September. I need people full of the Holy Ghost. I need people who've been in the meeting, who know how to pray, who sought God, who's been faithful. Not people up and down and in and out. We don't know whether you're going to show up. And when you show up, we're not knowing whether they're going to be, you know, in God or in hell. You know what I'm saying? You don't know whether you're in Satan or in God at the moment of time that you come. Whether you're in depression. There's another way to say it, okay? Are you with me?
Yes.
In doubt and unbelief. Because you never broke through. You deprioritize God. People, I want you to get sold out tonight. I want you to forget about the stuff. I want you to leave everything of the past behind. Look at it, say, neeners, neener, neeners. I'm never going to be that again. That's absolutely ridiculous. I'm done with that kind of a lifestyle. Hallelujah. I want to be shaped. Hallelujah. You see, God made an altar out of your life. You got to understand this before I get to the big thing here in a minute. Kubrasate. God made an altar out of your life that he won't allow human tool to touch. He made an altar out of your life when you were born again. A Holy Ghost place of communion with God, set apart and sanctified, a place where his name is. That place where he calls his name to dwell. My. Think about it. When you go and you get in that place where I cause my name to dwell, I'm going to tell you, I will answer you from heaven. I will hear you. I will respond with you. I will meet with you there. That's you. I'm my life. That's your life and my life. And yet we have not had eyes to see. Seeing, we could not see. We had no eyes to look and to behold. We had no ears to comprehend in the spiritual realm what God has done for us. Neither could we remember. We were always forgetting. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
But I've come to a point in time tonight that the spirit of wisdom and revelation is going to strike you. Hallelujah. Let me tell you, you spend your life preparing your heart to receive these kinds of things. You listen to me. You spend your life preparing your heart to receive these kind of things. These are moments in time that you labor to have. People who weren't laboring just got in doubt and unbelief and just stopped because then nothing was happening. I got discouraged and I've been praying a long time. Nothing happened. Been going to long church a long time. Nothing been giving a long time. Whatever. All the excuses. Long time. What do you mean? Long time. You don't even live no more. All that you have is not your own. You're so confused you don't even realize. That kind of language is just self-realization talk. In the fullness of the word, phrase, self-realization. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. God wants to give us God realization. Divine realization. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You sow through prayer, through plowing. Those seven men who are just an example of many other men in different times went in there and they plowed and they sowed and they prepared and they cried to God and intercede and supplication and persistent prayer till the rain started falling and the glory started blowing. Their hearts got prepared in that depth of desperate need for God, continually seeking Him and waiting on Him and not being discouraged because there was seemingly a delay, not wearying in well-doing, not fainting, but continually pressing in. Father, this is what you said to do. This is where you said I could meet with you, and I'm staying here in the meeting place. Hey, somebody says he's late. Somebody says he's not coming down. He's been up in the mountain too long. Make for us a calf, a golden calf, a God, that we may now have someone to lead us, that we may go back into our bondage. Turning to the earth, turning to the riches, turning to our own possession. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You can get accustomed to an anointing that is in the house that we go to someplace else and it's a blast. It mows people down. But you sit around in it so long that it's like normal to you. You know, there have been people in this house who I knew they could go away and they won't miss the house because they never became a part of the house. They could go away, they won't miss the anointing because they never got in the anointing. They can go to another church. They can go to a Baptist church. They won't miss anything. They won't remember because they never were. They were always on the outside. I try to tell them over and again. And they would just nod their head and act like they knew and they understood and know nothing and understand. It was spiritually revealed. It was very obvious. They never got needy. They never knew their need. Are you listening to me? Because I'm talking to you about something far greater than just the realms of the anointing that is present here in this place. There is a nation-shaking anointing, proven nation-shaking anointing in this house. Yes. There is a proven signs and wonders and miracles anointing in this house. Yes. There is a proven fellowship, manifest presence of God anointing in this place. Yes. And you got to honor it. Amen. And you got to value it. Amen. And it's got to be something more precious to you than anything else before, or you never have it. Not yours. Can't be yours. You got to hook up with it. If you don't value it, if you don't honor it, you're never going to hook up with it. This is going to be commonplace, and you're going to take the sacred and you're going to make it common. And you're going to take the holy and you're going to make it ordinary. Synonym, ordinary, synonym for profane, ordinary. Then you violate the sacred. Why? Because you have eyes you couldn't see. Look, they were watching Jesus. They were watching Jesus walk on water. They were watching Jesus take a few loaves and fish and feed, you know, tens of thousands of people. They had no eyes to see. They couldn't behold it. They could see from the natural, but it never sunk in. It never became a reality. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Oh, but I say this to you tonight because, I mean, I've had these many moments. I've had many moments of where there was a long time of prayer and seeking God, and it didn't seem like anything was happening. It didn't seem like anything was moving forward. I had his manifest presence. I had his grace. I had his goodness. I had this wonderful flow of heaven in my life. But it didn't seem like anything was moving forward. How little did I know early on in time that all was happening was my heart was being prepared to receive what God was going to say at a moment in time, 7 years, 8 years down the road. I was laboring that period of time to receive something, to be ready to receive it when the word came.
To have it.
While I watched around, as many people around me, same anointing, same word, same glory of God, nobody else saw it. No one else felt it. No one else grabbed it. Why? Because they weren't prepared to seek the Lord. They hadn't been, the ground wasn't being prepared. They weren't hungering and thirsting after righteousness. It wasn't about, God, I got. This is the best prayer I think you could pray. God, I've got to be used by you. Lord, use me more. Lord, show me how to do these works. Show me how to function in all that you've called me to do. Lord, I can't live without you. Listen, just that. It's that simple. I don't have to try to remember that. You know why? It's in me. It's my passion. I go to bed saying that. I wake up saying that. I walk through the day saying that. Hello. Yeah. Then my life is challenged and tested over and again. Is this really what you want? And he tests us and we don't even know it. He searches us when we don't even know it. To see what's going to come out of our mouth. See what your decisions are going to be. Oh, but I must tell you. Man, Ann and I were in a situation the other day. We ministered in a church and a person said, please come to our church, please. And I said, you know, I knew that our tickets, we were tired, we were worn out. And we just had to get some rest. We just needed to stop because of what we're getting ready to do. And I said, no, we can't. And then the Lord, I was reminded, wait a minute. Lord, I walked through every open door. And I said, honey, how about this? She said, baby, I'm tired. We're worn out. If we get back, if we go do this, we're going to get back, and we got to go right back out of town. How are we going to do this? I said, baby, sweetheart, listen. We said, we've been crying out to God. Every door you open, Lord, we'll walk through it. She said, okay, we can do this. Hey, praise God. Thank you, baby. So we can do this. We can do this. And she wasn't sleeping because she doesn't sleep in hotels. She just can't sleep. Bless her heart. Hit me again. I'm still breathing. And the Lord had, praise God, when we went to Dickinson, North Dakota, we got a hotel. I mean, so many times we let everybody else make the arrangements for us, and usually people don't know that you are doing this, that you're running wide open, and you're in the cheap hotel by the elevator. Ding, ding. And the blower on the top roof is just going all night long, okay? And you just got to be gracious and you got to do it. Are you with me? Huh? And Ann's there all night, like she's praying, she's interceding for the next day. And so we just said, okay, I called him back up. I said to Ann, I said, well, baby, let's just lay this before the Lord, okay? Because I want to do this. Let's just see what the Lord would do. First and foremost, we couldn't get our tickets changed. We'd have to buy whole new tickets because we just bought really inexpensive tickets and they're non-changeable. You change, you got to buy a new ticket. You know what I'm saying? So I said, okay, well, let me call up and talk to the person. I said, listen, called the pastor. I said, listen, we want to come. We're so honored that you want us to come. And they're like, we just so need you here. You know, that's a pool, man. We're doing it. We're bringing people together. We, the people that were in the meeting, we called people and they said, oh, they want you to come. They're just on and on and on. I said, listen, is there another way that we could come at another event, another time? Because, and I tell you, explain the situation, totally fine. So the Lord let us off the hook. But the bottom line of it is, we're constantly being challenged. We say things, and if we're not careful, we're going to go with what's convenient for us. And we could justify it. Because up until that time, we were running wide open, and now we're on the road. She's not sleeping, huh? I'm going hard. We're going to come back here. We're going to go. We're going to stay here 2 days, and then we're back off again. We justify it. But we say we can do a place. No. I'm not justifying nothing, no more. It don't matter what it costs me. It don't matter how intense it is. It doesn't matter how much sleep I don't have. It doesn't matter how much finances I'm left without. It doesn't matter. I'm going to take my life, oh God, and I want you to take my life, and I want you to pour it out as a drink offering before you. I want to be a living sacrifice. I want to be a whole burnt offering. I voluntarily give myself to you right now. Now, here's what's happened. Here's what happened. Because the few have borne the ministry of the many. The many have worn the few out, and they've died and went to early graves. Jack Cole, great anointing, great ministry, 38 years old, dead. John Hyde, great powerful ministry, poured out his life for the kingdom of God, did the work of many, died 47 years old. The list goes on. It's just on and on and on and on and on and on. We got to get into this thing together in a bigger way. And we don't have to make it up as we go because we've got the examples of the Word. And then all of a sudden you start spending your life for God and you start pouring everything out. Hallelujah. For the kingdom of God, as though that you're the one who's got to finance it all. You're the one who's got to support it all. You're not looking for somebody else to help out. You're willing to do it all. Yeah. Oh, we need to spread this around. No, this ain't no about spreading around. This is about you going. Yeah. Spread it around. Yes. There ain't no spreading around. There ain't no spreading around. There ain't nobody to spread it around to. That's the way it is for 2,000 years. The few have done the work of the many. If we could spread it around, then the many would have been doing the work of the few. There ain't no spreading it around. Hello. Yeah. Well, I want to just do my part in comparison to what somebody else is doing. You give 10, I'll give 10. I'm going to give it all. Amen. Yeah. Match that. Amen. Match that. Good. Don't spread it around. Match that. Match that. You match that. You match that. Jesus gave it all. You match that. Because he told us to do what he did. He said, you match that. Hallelujah. That's what he said. That's what he said. You come intimidate. You come intimidate. You come imitate me. You come follow me. You come take up your cross. You do what I did. And he empowers us. He said, do what I did. Oh, we want to do greater works. Why? So you can entertain your cat? Because the greater works is to go. The greater works is going into all the world. You're not going into the whole world. You want to have greater works. You can't get nothing. But this ain't for your entertainment and personal use. Huh? Are you listening to me? Hallelujah. 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 Okay, you ready? Here we go. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And then this is what the Lord told me to speak to you tonight. Speak over you tonight. I said, are you ready?
I'm ready.
Yes. Hallelujah. The Word of God is powerful.
Yes, it is.
The Word of God is living. Yes. Hallelujah. Sharper than any two-edged sword. The Word of God goes forth and accomplishes those things which Father has intended and purposed to bring forth in our life.
Amen.
The Word of God works mightily in us. The Word of God creates. Yes. Created all the universe and created a new creation in you and me when we were born of the Word. Amen. I want you to look at with me in Isaiah chapter 42. Same verse. Isaiah 42:18. Hear ye deaf. And look, ye blind, that ye may see. Hallelujah. Hear ye deaf, and look ye blind, that ye may see. Hallelujah. 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 Harabasetea. Hallelujah. Yarabakana Jayasaya. Woo! Ma. Ha! 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 Hallelujah! Hallelujah! Hallelujah!
Hallelujah.
Mambrandaya sata. Hallelujah. Oh, hamanangadaya ha. Ho kremananaya sheda manadaya paho. Manlana mbonjakaya. Mamamandaya rushapaya.
For Lord, the Lord says, seeing ye shall see, and hearing ye shall hear, and your heart shall understand. For I have opened up your eyes that you may behold. And I have opened up your ears that you may hear. And I have given you an understanding heart that you may understand these things of life and of heaven, that you may begin to move out in the realms of interaction with me, of beholding that which I'm doing, of seeing that which I'm doing, of hearing that which I am saying, of understanding that of which I've asked of you, that you may move in these wonderful miracles that seeing the Father do, you may do them also. And hearing the Father say them, you may also speak them. And as you speak them, they shall produce within you great life, great boldness, great faith. They shall produce within you the outworking of my Spirit. And all around you, you shall begin to see those things which I have declared by my Spirit and revealed in my Word. And you shall not lack. Oh, there shall be no lack in you. Oh, no, no. But I shall give you great provision. Oh, and all that you set your heart to do, I shall do it with you, says the Lord. I shall make you great. You shall not be small. I shall make you great. And you shall do these things which my Spirit has given you the ability and the power to do. By my name, you shall conquer. By my name, you shall reach out beyond the world, beyond the worlds that you understand, into the far reaches, into the far reaches of the Spirit. Hallelujah. Into the far reaches of my anointing. Into the far reaches of my glory. Oh! Hear ye! Hear ye! Hear ye! Hear ye! Oh, deaf, hear ye that ye may hear. Oh, look and see, ye that be that ye are, ye that have been blind. Hallelujah. Look! Look, ye that have been blind. Look! Look! Look, you that have been blind. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. That you may see. Hallelujah. 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 For the Spirit of the Lord. For the Spirit of the Lord shall cause you to see. Shall cause you to hear. Shall cause you to remember. Mondaya. Murafa. 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 Nasia dianogo yishinamayan nasita la musikaya. I command this body right now in the name of Jesus. Right now in the name of Jesus. To come under the divine order of the Spirit of the Lord. To be able to accept in every way. Little Bambito. Hallelujah. 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 Break the power of this old nauseous thing. In Jesus' name, I command the stomach to work right. Now in Jesus' name. Now in Jesus' name. Thank you, Father, for the anointing. The spirit of affliction. You obey me. You obey me now in Jesus' name. It would create a sensation of nauseousness and cause the body to reject food. You foul spirit of hell, I bind you now in the name of Jesus Christ, and you leave the property of the Most High God alone. Father, I thank you for a praying church that grabs a hold of the things that you have ordained, that you have demanded should be. You see, God has demanded. He has demanded signs and wonders for the gospel. He's demanded it, and we're willing to be without it. I was telling somebody today, I'm going to preach. I'm going to preach with a pillar of fire above me. I'm going to do these works and greater works. I am one given to greater works. I'll have nothing to do with less than that. Somebody might say, well, what about that happened to you? And what about that other thing that happened to you? And what about that other lack? And what about that other discouragement? What about that other disappointment? All I can say is I have no idea what you're talking about. Because though I passed through the fire, I was not burned. The flame did not kindle upon me. When I walked through the water, I did not drown. God's church is going to have to learn how to move as one body and one person. God's church is going to have to learn how to so take a hold of those things which Father has said, that no matter what's standing in front of us, no matter what challenges we face, we do not lose our vision of the heavenly call and the divine purpose. And we become radical about it. I'm going to tell you right now, when you get radical about something, you're missing something that you're supposed to have, and it's a matter of life and death, I'm going to tell you right now, you get radical. I'm going to tell you right now, your prayer goes from some little mealy-mouthed whisper, you listen to me, to an earnest cry of passion and desperation. And nobody says, I'm going to wait for the Holy Ghost, give me that. Well, I'm going to tell you right now, you got it now. Because seeing, you can see. You're not going to hide no more in the darkness. Mind-blinding spirits aren't going to be able to work against you anymore. You're not going to be able to just have eyes to see earthly things. In fact, when your eyes begin to see heavenly, you don't even see the earthly anymore. It loses all of its glamour, lose all of its appeal, lose all of its interest. You begin to act different, dress different, think different, behave different, move different. Everything is about what Father wants. Tell you right now, we're going to build that church out there on the ranch, MTC Church, in July. I haven't gotten an update of what the total pledges are, what's come in so far, total pledges. 48,000, 49,000. Praise God. That right there is a testimony of doing it. And what we're going to do when we dedicate that church, I will not allow any status quo, nothing. No way. It will be set at the highest precedence of flowing in the anointing. Of flowing in the anointing. We're not going to have some bangity bang bang clangity clang clang worship. It's going to be Holy Ghost. If it's got to be a cappella, it's going to be Holy Ghost. It's going to be flowing in the anointing if all we can do is just nothing but sing in the Spirit. Hallelujah. We're going to set the precedence of that. It's going to be Holy Ghost. That's all it's going to be. When that church is planted, I'm going to tell you right now, we are going to plant something that we're not going to be embarrassed about having someone come from Nepal who's been in a signs and wonders miracle meeting to come to hear clangity clang clang and bangity bang bang and status quo and just another whatever. It's going to be Holy Ghost through and through. Hallelujah. I tell you right now, I believe if the church got so real with God that they just wanted the manifestation of the Holy Ghost, that they hunkered down and said, we just going to pray in the Holy Ghost and sing in the Holy Ghost until something greater happens, that would be the foundation there in itself. Oh, people would have the things to say. They'd pull out 1 Corinthians 14 right, left, and center, even though they never done it ever before in their life anyway. That'd be just quoting verses of Scripture to try to shut down the move of God. Don't matter, because you wouldn't be doing that too long. And then the preaching would come out of that, and the singing would come out of that. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
And we're not reproducing nothing that doesn't look like this.
Amen.
And more.
Amen.
We're going after what Father has purposed.
Amen.
Everybody has the right to plug in and participate with what we're doing. But I'm telling you right now, every year or even every month that you let pass and you didn't plug into what we have, you just robbed yourself and you put yourself way back. And especially after tonight. Because Papa says, you see. But you know, there's a greater responsibility. Tonight we bless you. I'm telling you right now, tonight you bless the Father, release that anointing into your life. But there comes a greater responsibility with being able to see. I have more responsibility. You have more responsibility than the people in the back jungles of Africa and the back jungles of Bangladesh, in the ridges of the Himalayas, and the mountains of Tajikistan. And there's more required of us. They may be able to do things and get away with things and make heaven based upon the fact that they called upon the name of Jesus and they're doing everything they know to do is what was been revealed to them in the new birth, and many things that we would say, wow, that's just totally wrong. But they don't know any better. They got Jesus, that's all they know. Whereas you and I would, Father said, no, I'm. See, it's the beautiful thing about the knowledge of the Lord and about this unveiling of the things of the Spirit is that you get to have the opportunity to step into all of the works of Jesus. The bad thing is that if you don't do it and you receive such grace, ask Paul about it. Ask Paul about what it looks like to be a castaway because you didn't run the race because you drew back. See, there's a responsibility. We want, and we're not going to let up. We're not going to say, oh, well, we don't put too much responsibility on people. No, we don't give you the responsibility.
Amen.
And then we've got to warn you. You compare yourself with somebody else? You can't. Because they're not in the position you're in. They're not in the place and the call and the opportunity that you're in. They're not living in the house you're living in, under the same mantle of the anointing that you're under. Huh? They haven't had everybody that God's raised up to do great signs and wonders in our generation come lay hands on their head. Like you have. I want you just to understand tonight, dear people, this is the force of your will. It's the force of your will. You let your life be poured out as a drink offering. You decide you don't lay any more claim to your own life. You do what the Holy Spirit has commissioned you to do, because the foundation of what we preach tonight before we release this word to you that the Lord gave to us is that you have decided that you no longer live your own life. Look, we are going to build one of the greatest youth camps in the nation. We're going to do it. Because we're not only going to reach out into the nations of the earth, but we reach this nation. And there's no way to reach these nations like starting camps in the summertime for ages 6 all the way up to 18. And then when we go through those camps, we do those camps 12 weeks out of the year, we glean the ones who we see are responding to the call of God, and they come back for a deeper walk camp, for missions training camp. And I know that some of the folks up in Washington State are ready. Zeke, he wants to come down. He needs to know the date for the mission training camp and for the summer camp. Seeding for missions, because that's really what that's about. So you're going to just have to say, look, you know what? There are too many places for me to serve in the kingdom. And you don't have to think it out and work it out. You pray it out. You begin to get desperate with God. Say stuff like, Father, I'm about ready to sell my house. I need you to talk to me. Father, I'm about ready to buy a one-way ticket to anywhere that hasn't heard. I need you to talk to me. Father, I got to be used by you. I need you to show me. Father, I've not been fruitful. I've been unfruitful, and I don't want to live like this no longer. I guarantee you, this is the way I talk to Father. Things have changed for you. You'll understand the life of the overcomer. You'll understand what it means to be anointed of God. Hallelujah. You understand what it means to live in divine provision, divine power. Hallelujah. To have divine blessings. I was so blessed today, yesterday. Elizabeth, you're 26 now, 27. She's got a husband coming real soon. I'm always thinking about that. I'm always praying about it. Father, God's got something big planned.
Yes, he has.
She's 27. She calls me yesterday. She texted me yesterday. She said, Dad, I've got this opportunity. I wanted to pass it by you first to find out what you thought. Here's what it is. See, the reality of it is when people do that to me, I don't take it as them talking to me. I appreciate that. I value that. That's honorable. That's obedience to God. That's the ways of the kingdom. You're talking directly to the Father. Because that's where you learn how to submit yourself to God. People just think that they rely upon their own self. They rely upon their own human ability. And they just make it up as they go. Well, I think I want to do this. And then pray nothing through. Not only did you not pray it through, you didn't even have the wisdom to go and present it before God in the proper profession. You're going to have to stop that. Because you're fashioning yourself after men. And not after Christ Jesus, who did nothing unless he saw the Father do it. And you understand where that begins. The preaching that he did at the age of 12 years old captivated the great scholars and the wise men of his day. The scripture says he went home and submitted himself to his parents until the time of his showing to Israel, the time the Father would send him out. And that was a course of a total of 30 years. Jesus was in the making and the preparation. And I count that as a model in the house. Because people say, oh, no, we got to get out there and do something. Listen, I'm going to tell you right now, you spend 40 years seeking God, you spend 30 years seeking God, you'll do more in a day than you'd have done in that 40 years. Doing it on your own. You'll do more in a day. Just imagine what you'll do with the next 40 years. We see the consecration of Joshua. We see his unwillingness to depart from the glory. We see his way he served Moses when his eyes were open. When he was given the ability to see, there was something far more than just humanity going on in his life. We see then what took place in his consecration to lay down his life, in his consecration of the word, when he said, as for me and my house, we'll serve the Lord. You guys make your own choices. This is what God has told us to do. As for me and my house, we will wholly follow God. We will wholly follow God. And dear people, we've got to recognize that our inheritance right now is not wells that we did not dig, vineyards that we did not plant, houses that we did not build. It's not our inheritance. Our inheritance is the life and the power of Jesus Christ, which is all about going into all the world and preaching the gospel. I hear it. I shout like that because I'm so overwhelmed by the anointing. I can hear the people crying out, come to us. Come over to us. I can see their faces. I see the demon possessed when they're completely liberated. No one lay their hands on them. Demon possessed, completely liberated. We've seen supernatural things where it was like, where the devils would just take people and do unimaginable superhuman feats with their bodies. And then in total deliverance, standing there saying, I just met Jesus. Face is shining. Going from complete insanity over into the realms of glory. I see those faces. I hear their calls. I hear Father saying, who will go for us? I hear Father saying, who will go for us? I hear him say it. Who will go for us? See? That's the way it's got to be. That's the partnership. That's the way God set it up. That's our divine privilege and opportunity to share with God in this glorious thing called the gospel. Who will go for us? That we get to go in his stead. That we get to be his ambassadors. That we get to be those who function in the authority of sonship. Ah! Under the majesty. Under the majesty and the administration of the Holy Ghost. Under the authority and mantle of a great high priest, Jesus Christ. Tonight, I pray that every person standing in this place, from the front row to the back row, for those whose hearts were prepared to receive all that God said tonight, and for those whose hearts are in the process of being prepared, that you will understand that the very basis and the very foundation of what God is declaring is that you forsake it all. She forsake it all. That your whole life becomes about living for the King. Living for heaven. Brother Yun's going to be here on Sunday. And here's one of the few doing the work of the many. They got so wore out that his wife collapsed and was in the hospital for 2 months. Almost dead. Running every day. All over. Because there's so few to go. There's so few. Somebody said, oh, no, I'll go. No, there's so few to go with the anointing. There's so few to go. People want the touch of God. They want what only the Holy Spirit can minister. There's so few that have it when God has made it available to all. But only those who cannot live without it step into it. And when you can't live without it, you start doing it. You don't have to wait for no permission slip. You already got one. Hallelujah. Praise God. Hallelujah. And it's done in divine order too. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Just lift your hands towards heaven. Just lift your hands towards heaven. Sukara basara de manea tetela bosata. Oh, mamma manetia. Arriba basara. Hidana mosai. I just want you to thank God. Just begin to worship Him. Just begin to worship Him. Just begin to pour your heart out to Him for all the great things that He's done for you. For the great things that He's done for you tonight. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Hallelujah. Father, I thank you for the Abiding Place Church. Father, I thank you for so many willing people. Father, for so many hungry hearts. Father, I thank you for everybody in this place tonight that came and at this divine moment, in this divine opportunity, received that which you've freely given. And that there would be not one single person in this place that would take for granted that which you supplied. But with eyes wide open, with ears able to hear, they will begin to see and begin to listen. Begin to understand. As their life begins to be lived out as a living sacrifice like never before. As they begin to give themselves to you, oh God. As they begin to press past all the things that have hindered them. All the stuff that has held them back.
Because I believe tonight that the many in this place have decided that you're not going to be without what God has demanded. You decided that you're not going to lay your hands on people and the anointing not be present. You decided that you're not going to speak the word of God without signs and wonders. You decided that you're not going to live your life barren and unfruitful, but you're going to see souls come into the kingdom. You decided. You decided. You decided. You decided that you're going to lay down your life when you feel like reacting. You decided that you're going to be willing to be persecuted and humble yourself. You decided that you're going to love when you're hated. Hallelujah. That you're going to speak life when you're cursed. Hallelujah. You've decided tonight you're not going to play games. You're not playing no games. You decided that everything that you have, you're selling it. By simply saying, Lord, all that I have, everything, I write it out to you. It's yours. Mandaras te kipredaya. I will it to you. You hear me? The will. I will it to you. People, let me just say this. When you begin to start, and you're not, I know you're not going to do this anymore. But in the past, let me tell you, when you've complained about your giving, when you've complained about the stretch and the opportunities that God gave you, you complained about it, all you did was curse yourself. All you did was limit yourself. All you did was cause the anointing to back off because you said, I'm not ready for you, God. That's all you did because you didn't understand what you were doing. But now you're going to understand. Now you're going to do what we do. When we're stretched beyond all possibility, we go ahead and begin to cry out to God, stretch me more, Lord. When we seem like that there's nothing left and there's no possible way for us to make the next move, we start rejoicing in God for the miracle. See, we have to deal with the doubt and the discouragement more than anybody else in this place, because the more you do in the kingdom, the more you're going to be the target. But we found the way to move past all of that, to mount up with wings, to run and not be weary. We found this place of praise and worship that makes all the rest of the stuff irrelevant, because all we want is heaven. We care not for our own life. How much less do we care for our possessions? And you cannot walk with God by any means less. I said, according to the word of God, you cannot walk with God by any less commitment. Hallelujah. So wear yourself out for the kingdom. Just let God take your job and go ahead and allow that to grow and mature into a gift of faith, to where that you go beyond what your job could do, because you start crying out to God because you agreed with the house. What everybody else says is an end time special revelation from heaven that we received, that maybe you haven't heard because you couldn't hear, but you can hear now. That now business is going to start serving ministry instead of ministry serving business. You understand, God gave us an end time revelation in this house that the church is supposed to hear throughout the nation. And I never had ears to hear, but now I do. Because you begin to cry, because when you hook up with it, you recognize it was from heaven, it was a word from heaven, then you start agreeing with it, and then you start praying it out, and you start living it out. That's what's going to happen. God's going to work it out. I said, you start praying it out, you start living it out, then God's going to work it out. And you're going to leave your job because you're going to get promoted in something like what happened with Allie. Because it wasn't an idea. A lot of people get ideas. We'll see what ideas do for you. Then there's gifts of faith. then there's something that comes from heaven. Hallelujah. I found over and again that people do not want to imitate the anointing. They want to have something original. Can I just pop your bubble right now? There is no original. It's about time you start humbling yourself and following people who get something from God. God gives gifts and anointing so that you can follow them, serve them, inherit them, not compete with them. How many times have you had to hear, now you can hear, that competition, compromise, and comparisons is a demonic realm. And many people are motivated by all three of those at once. At once. They live out their life making decisions based upon competition, comparisons, and compromises. You're not going to do that anymore because you hear. You go, hey, wait a minute. That's the voice of the devil. That's the voice of the world. That's the voice of the spirit of darkness. I'm not moving by that anymore. And then you're going to go, wow, I spent a lot of my life making my decision out of that. And then all of a sudden you collapse to your knees and you begin to sob. Because suddenly you understood. See, suddenly you understood. You never really dropped to your knees and began to sob until you understood. It's revelation from heaven. And I'm going to tell you right now, people, Papa's done giving you something. Papa's done giving you something. Oh, treasure him, treasure him, treasure him, treasure him. He's the greatest gift. He's the greatest gift. Jesus is the greatest gift. The Holy Ghost is the greatest gift. I don't know where it was. I don't know where it was. Somewhere we were recently. And I was tired and I was worn out because I'm telling you, we've just been pushing so hard for the past 4 years. We just pushed it so hard. And it was somewhere I was recently. Early in the morning, it was really early. And I was trying to sleep. I was just almost too tired to sleep. And I could hear people in this church praying for me, praying for the meeting. I started getting strengthened. If we could just understand the value of a prayer, if we could understand that we can pray in a move of God upon a nation, yes, that we can pray in a move of God upon a generation,
yes, Lord. Yes. Thank you, Jesus.
That out of desperation, we can see the rain begin to fall and the Spirit of God begin to pour out, that our prayers can bring the lost who've never heard into the kingdom. It can melt the hardest heart of rebellion and cause them to become submissive and sensitive to God. It can take a worn out preacher. I mean, I think I told you this the other night. We were in a meeting and I'm telling you, that morning, this the power of God fell. It fell. You know, it was beautiful what God did. And, whew, His goodness. It's just all Him. Amen. Just learning how to flow in the anointing and some of this. Beautiful.
Thank you, Lord.
People's lives are touched. I love to see people have an encounter with Jesus. Amen. Without having to spend 50 years talking to them. See, it started happening in 5 minutes. Because they're just not used to the anointing. They're not used to that encounter. And it's like, poof. Oh, thank you, Jesus. And I want you to see the thing about it is, as you begin to receive in this realm where there's more available to you, God's enlarging your heart to even have a greater capacity to receive more. Because we haven't even begun. We're just scratching the surface. I want so much more. And it's like a floodgate open to many people because there's so much famine in the land. And I'm telling you right now, I get up that morning, and I thought I was going to faint. I don't know if I ever felt that in my life. And, I mean, it was just the weirdest feeling. I was all disoriented. I got in the shower, and it got worse in the hot shower, so I couldn't even take a shower. You know what I did? And I could hardly do that because I was hurting. See, I've learned I don't let nothing master me but God the Holy Ghost. And we just You can hear better than you've ever heard before. And you're not going to let it either. I'm yours, oh God. And then we got to the meeting. And I stood up to start singing. And as soon as I started to start singing, I started feeling like I was going away. I'm just like, my head started pounding. It's almost like I couldn't see. So it was the weirdest feeling. And I thought, well, if I don't sing, I'll be all right. You know what I did? You know what I did when I sang? I sang louder. But if you sing too loud, you're gonna make it worse. You're gonna make more blood rush to your head. Loud! Come on, hallelujah. I learned a long time ago. And I'm trying to teach you. Hallelujah. Ah, we'll say it. Then I started picturing myself because I feel so bad. I feel so woozy. I know I'm getting ready to minister. I sit back down. I'm trembling. My body's shaking. I'm just trembling. I started picturing myself passing out and dying. I'm not kidding you. That's how bad I felt. Having like a massive heart attack, a stroke, something, you know, I felt that weird. Dying. Imagining the pastor saying, does he normally do this? And what Ann's going to be doing. You know what I did when I started imagining that? You know what I did? I shut it down. Because those things just flash through your mind, right? If you're not careful. See, I've learned not to go with thoughts and imagination. You're going to learn too. I've learned that no matter what's going on, I know what's happening here. I'm getting ready to break the strong man's heart. I know what's going on. And many times these things will attack our bodies. They'll attack our bodies. They don't just attack our thoughts. They attack our bodies. They'll press sore against us. And Paul said, I fought with beasts at Ephesus. I'm sitting there like that. And then I got introduced. They introduced me. I stood up. As soon as I stood up, poof. Hallelujah. The mantle of the Holy Ghost. Hey? Mantle of the Holy Ghost. I preached so loud, right? So strong. It wasn't too rapid. It was pretty rapid fire. It was machine gun fire, but it was. And you know, you have to understand this. These things not only go on in that dimension I described to you, in that circumstance I described to you, but they go on in the dimensions and the circumstances which you face on a daily basis. And they're not as that dramatic, and they're not as that much intense, but it's preparation ground for you no longer to be pushed around to say, no, I got the high ground. I'm not bending, I'm not bowing. I'm not being overwhelmed. I'm not going to be stopped. I don't need to sleep that much. Hallelujah. 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 Can I tell you what happened to me? Just tell you this recently, because I want you to get this. I want you to understand to apply this. Okay, Sunday night, left here, power of God, glory. Ooh, hallelujah. Went to sleep, power of God, glory. Woke up in the morning, I was just really tired. Because we go pretty hard on Sunday. And So I went to work doing stuff. And I was just tired. Just kind of hanging out, just working on the book, doing a few other things. And then I ate something around 4 o'clock, and I fell off to sleep. And then it's about 7 o'clock. It's prayer time. So tired. I'm so worn out, Lord. I don't have anything left. You know, you've done that, right? I'm like, what you talking about? I'm not kidding you. What you talking about? And I got out to pray, and it was just like a ba 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 ba. You know what I'm saying? It's like, what is this?
I know what this is. See, I recognize that ba-ba-ba-ba prayer. I recognize what that is. Where you don't feel it, it's not gushing. I know what that is. That's stinking hindrance. I know what that is. You know what I did? I got after it. I said, oh God, I need you to help me right now. I need you to strengthen me right now. I began to lift my voice and cry out. I went and got water on my face. I went, I started crying out to God. God, I got in the shower. I wake myself up. Oh, God. And then, bang, the break came. I tell you right now, I started gagging. Just this thing coming at me. Just, and then it came and started coming, that warring tongue. I started breaking things. It was, otherwise, it would have just been there. I'd have gone to sleep with that. And I just got it a long time ago. I'm not going to bed with the devil. And what I recognize is that many people live in the hindrance because they've never known the distinction. They just let the hindrance, I'm too tired, I'm too weary, I have nothing left, I'm burnt out. And they take it as a natural thing. I don't take it as a natural thing, you see. I take it as a spiritual thing, because that's what it is. Because I can break it. See, I discovered long ago that I can break it. And that it is a demonic realm. It is not just a physical realm. And people get weird about this. Oh, that's weird. No, it's weird to you. I'm going to tell you why it's weird to you, because you don't want to do it or recognize it. And I'm talking to people on the web now, because now you guys see. I'm talking about people on the web now. As soon as you get out of the natural realm and you begin to start in being involved in the spiritual realm. You know what happened the next morning? I woke up and I wasn't even in control. Was pouring out of me. I had to go somewhere. I got in the truck. I mean, there was no stopping it. I mean, I had to get out and, you know, turn the truck in to get it worked on. And it's still, I mean, just it's not even your will. It's just gushing out. You know what it is? You know what it is? Because you broke through in that realm. Everybody's broke through in that realm, right? We're just a gusher. It just, you can't even shut it off, right? How about knowing that you can actually live in that realm if you deal with the hindering spirits? How about knowing? How about having an understanding heart? How about being able to see? Because it's our will. I could have just said there, oh God, Lord, I know you understand. And if I would have asked Ann, she would have said, yes, honey, you go lay down, go lay down. You need to lay down. You're not resting. I'm not asking her. Because she's going to encourage the wrong thing. She's going to baby me and tell me I don't have to do another thing for the rest of my life. I've done more than anybody has done already. So you just lay right here and take and sleep and rest, and I'll take care of everything. It's her. So she, no. And I could have said, oh, Father knows, he understands. I poured out my heart yesterday. I'm worn out. But we left that long ago. When we were a child, we spake like a child. Then we grew up. And I put away childish things. And I began to engage in a battle for the souls of men. Because I know what happened Monday night. Monday night, I busted through for Cuba. No, that's where it went. Monday night, I busted through for the church. Monday night, I broke through for things, some other things that were going on, for some other people. Busted through. All this going, all the whole interplay was this. The whole interplay was everything in the realms of this world, in the spirit of this world, in the spirit of darkness, did not want me to step into the appointment I had in God to break through in that realm. I discovered that the more the sacrifice, the greater the blessing. The more you risk your life and the more you lay down your life, the higher the ground that you take, the more ground you take. I want you to get it, because you're going to be able to get it now. You're going to be able to see and you can see. Hearing you can hear. And now you remember. And now you remember. Hallelujah. You know, they still didn't get it, because they were still saying things like, when Jesus said we're going to go raise Lazarus from the dead, they're saying like, oh, let's go die with him. You know, and they didn't get it. They had to wait for Pentecost, but we're in it.
We in Pentecost. We in Pentecost. Hallelujah. 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 Can you hear that? Do you hear that right there? Do you hear that right there? Right there. That was beautiful. That was beautiful. Many churches, I would say even maybe the majority of churches, that would be great exploits of revival if they could do that. There's so many pastors that long for the church to do that. I'm going to tell you right now, I just so praise God that you have, that you're able to do that, that you're able to go there when we begin to flow there. Hallelujah. And I'm on just a day. I just want to encourage you. How Monday they stay? Tonight, I did not want Ruthie Anna leaving this place with this nauseousness in her body. She's got little baby in there, and her body thinks that it's been invaded with foreign matter. And she's not been able to really hold any food down. And it makes you really weak when you're throwing up. We got a bit of a breakthrough on Sunday night. And then things started coming back last night with vengeance. And we're just going to break through it. Look at me, baby. We're going to break through it. Break through it. Your spirit is bigger than your body. I said your spirit is bigger than your body. And you access that realm. But I said that it came to the Lord. So in Jesus' name. No more
in Jesus' name. It's done. It's over.
Jesus' name. We get to break through things like this just to be stronger on the other side. We go through some, we've been through some very intense battles. We passed through the water. Isaiah 43:1. But we did not drown. It was scary because the waves passed over our head. We walked through the fire, but we were not burned.
Amen.
Neither did the flame kindle upon us. And that wasn't just, and of course, you know, Isaiah is talking about the situation that Israel would be in as they go out into their captivity because of their disobedience. But God says, I'm still with you. I'll still be with you. Even in your captivity, even in your discipline, I'll still be with you. So that it was proven in the lives of Daniel's three companions. The flame did not kindle on them. Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Lord Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you for your grace. Your healing power. Father, we thank you for this great prophet that's in the womb.
Yes.
We thank you, Father God. You take and strengthen Ruthie Anna by your spirit in her inner being. She may stand strong in the bearing of this that you're bringing forth from the fruit of her body.
Thank you.
Mahanati. Mahanateam.
Yes.
In the great struggle for this life, it's here in the womb. In the great battle, as it were, where the spiritual things that are taking place right now as babies being formed in her womb, and in the secret parts, all of his members being arranged, so that God can take yet another's life and separate this life from his mother's womb, so that he might reveal his son in him.
Yes.
Yeah.
Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Lord God, for this great anointing. Hallelujah.
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 For this great prophet on the inside.
Yes.
Tom Bresaya. Thank you, Jesus. Look at me, baby.
We love you so much.
How you doing?
Blessed.
Are you feeling better? Let me tell you what I feel. I feel great peace. Sunday night, I felt a little bit of having to go after it and an opposing enemy. Just a spiritual thing trying to afflict your body. Right now, I just feel great peace. We just love you so much. Big old hug over here. Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Praise God. Hallelujah. I personally do not want this meeting to end. And it's not going to end. Because the things that God has done in your life will continue on for the tonight. Will continue on to the rest of your life. That is the wonderful thing about the anointing. It never stops. What we receive from heaven is with us. All we've got to do is it's a new life, as it were, new seed that is germinated, new seed that is not just, it's not just in the critical area of potentially not producing. It's there. And now all you have to do is nurture it by obedience, participation, and just grows. And you don't allow it to get entangled with things that cares this life, so it gets choked. We take care of it because it's precious fruit. Father waits for the precious fruit. It's a manifestation of the life and power of Jesus through us. It's precious fruit. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. No burning sensation either. Thank you, Jesus. Just one more time, lift your hands towards heaven. When to heaven? When to heaven? When to heaven? Hallelujah.
Great anointing. Great anointing. Great anointing. Great anointing. Great anointing. On Jasa today, Adonai, Fatanade. Fit for the battle. Fit for the battle. Fit for the battle. Well, dear people, worship the Lord with your giving and find a bunch of people and hug them and bless them. Tell them that you love them.